Okay, right. Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is to take evidence on the National Performance Framework. Before we start our evidence session, I would like to put on record my thanks to all those who took part in the workshops in relation to our National Performance Framework Ambitions into Action inquiry last week. Hope everyone found the events in Dundee and Glasgow useful and interesting. I know I certainly did, and colleagues I've spoken to, I believe, certainly did too. Building on last week's discussions, we now return to taking formal evidence as part of our inquiry, and our witnesses today are Dr Ian Elliott, Senior Lecturer in Public Leadership and Management at Northumbria University and Honorary Chair of the UK Joint University Council. We only have an hour and a half for this session. I thought I was going to spend most of it reading out your qualifications. Dr Max French, Lecturer in Systems Leadership at Newcastle Business School, Northumbria University, and Jennifer Wallace, Director of Carnegie UK. So good morning to everyone. I'd like to welcome you all to the meeting and thank you for your written submissions to the inquiry. So we'll move straight to questions. And the first question is that in reference to the Auditor General, he said, and I quote in terms of a blog published on the 7th of September, that Scotland is suffering from a major implementation gap between policy ambitions and delivery on the ground. And goes on to say, I'm not convinced that public sector leaders really feel accountable for delivery change. What does the panel feel about that? Who'd like to go first?
I certainly recognise a lot in that from my own research. The idea of implementation, I think, is an interesting one. When the performance framework was first set up, and that's going back some time now, it was really designed within the Scottish Government itself as a tool to get the Scottish Government officials and indeed ministers to think more strategically, to move away from a mindset of thinking in granular detail about inputs and outputs, to thinking more about outcomes. And that proved to be very successful at the time. I think, and one of the aspects of that was freeing up local government in particular through the Concordat that was developed at the time, to free up local government and remove a lot of ring fencing of budgets and things like that, to free them up for implementation. And what I think has happened, part of what's happened over time, is that a lot of that ring fencing has come back. And obviously since 2008 we've had austerity, we've had the COVID pandemic, you know, there have been a lot of major crises which have really constrained local government in terms of what they can do to innovate and how they can better implement these things. So I think, you know, there are a lot of challenges that we've got to recognise in that. But at the same time, you know, I do worry that some of that strategic mindset within government has been lost, and there's slowly creeping back again a kind of focus on, you know, things like how many police officers you have, you know, on the ground and things like that, rather than thinking more strategically about the outcomes that we're trying to deliver on. So I do recognise a lot of what the Auditor General has said, and I think they're doing actually a lot of really good work in this area at the minute.
Okay. Ms Wallace?
Thank you. Just to agree that we would share that view that the Auditor General has laid out, that there is an implementation gap. I think in our evidence what we were trying to focus on was where the golden thread between the national outcomes and delivery gets lost. And actually there is a significant amount of implementation process that could have been put in place and the infrastructure to support it that was lacking. Now in our work at Carnegie and also in Dr French's work, we've seen examples from other countries where they put in that scaffolding to support an approach to outcomes, and we can very clearly see that using the comparative evidence that scaffolding is missing in Scotland and part of the problem here with implementation.
Okay, Dr French.
Thank you. And just to agree also with the Auditor General's comments, and I think what we're beginning to see now is quite clear evidence of an implementation gap even within the devolved nations. Scotland has achieved less implementation depth within government than in Wales, and also since the whole of society approach since 2018, we can see less of a kind of a horizontal integration within a range of public bodies and even in sort of third sector organisations than in Wales. And I think there's several reasons behind that. The main one is that there's been a lack of a proper implementation strategy in Scotland. The emphasis has been more on measurement than what you do with the measures. So I think the lack of a strategy is really becoming evident in the patterns of implementation outcomes. We've submitted a paper which sort of systematically compares Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland on their implementation of their national level outcomes and indicators that sort of supports that view. But I think also there's an opportunity now with the upcoming review propositions of new legislation to really kind of make up some of the ground. And I think that the focus of this inquiry can support that.
I mean, you have said, Dr. French, in your submission that the NPF has achieved limited but improving implementation success. But the Scottish Leaders Group, Leaders Action Group, they say that the current status of accountability against the NPF is patchy, and typically the NPF is not actively used to shape scrutiny, provide sponsorship, undertake commissioning work, or shape the allocation of funding. So is there improvements, and where are these improvements taking place, and where is the area where we need to focus most on in terms of actually ensuring the NPF delivers on what it's supposed to do?
Yeah, I would say, in terms of the improvement, since 2018, there's been dedicated leadership within the Scottish Government, within the Performance and Outcomes Directorate. Mm-hmm. There's been a small team doing external communications and engagement in that, and working internally with government very slowly to change some of the processes that are involved in reporting and policy making and so forth. I would say probably too slow, but it's a very small team. So I think in terms of the implementation, there's been a very slow, gradual improvement and focus on that. Also, the externalisation of this to an external whole-of-society approach rather than a whole-of-government approach has really galvanised some interest, external interest, and also, as you're seeing through the through the Accountability and Incentives Group within the Scottish Leaders Forum, really, when you get external people involved in some of the scrutiny, which is something that Scotland has lacked, hasn't had an external scrutiny organisation for its NPF, there's more energy and more criticality brought to it, as I think you can see through their contribution to the inquiry.
Okay. We actually found when we were out last week and we were a huge amount of enthusiasm and energy for the NPF, but it's about how widespread that is, and I think your research is very important in identifying where there are issues, and indeed the Scottish Leaders Action Group is too. Now, Ms Wallace, in your response you say that while there are some sectors and directorates where the national outcomes are more visibly embedded, there are many places where other statutory duties or non-legislative frameworks are seen to take precedence. Just wonder if you can give us some examples of that.
Of course, thank you. So I think there are two recent examples where we have drawn attention to a very surface level alignment. The first one is the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which includes only two references to the National Performance Framework and no explicit references to the statutory national outcomes. I think it is difficult to view that as a way to say that they have had regard to it. I think they have put in some sentences and added a reference to the National Performance Framework, but it does not feel that the National Strategy for Economic Transformation is aligned to the national outcomes in a way that we would have hoped from an external organisation. Mm-hmm. The other one that we've been actively involved in, so we are members of the Children in Scotland Policy and Strategy Forum and have been for a number of years, been very actively interested in improving children's outcomes through that cross-sectoral group. And we had engaged with Scottish Government on the children's wellbeing outcomes, hoping that that would be a children's version of the National Performance Framework. That was what we understood the intention of it to be. The process that was gone through was to identify indicators that are currently in use by local government that relate to largely to children's services. And what has come out of that process is really a children's services outcome framework. So a framework that looks at SHINARI, which are the personal outcomes for children and young people, and GERFEC, which are service outcomes for children's services. And why does that matter? It matters because there are a huge number of things that are important to children's wellbeing that are now not included in that draft framework. So that includes, for example, access to play spaces, which we know are really important to children and young people. And they say themselves how important that is to their own wellbeing. There's no information in there on air pollution, yet we know a huge amount about the relationship between air pollution and asthma and children's long-term health outcomes. So by taking that narrow prism instead of a holistic wellbeing approach, it doesn't, to us, conform to the ambition of the National Performance Framework. So those are just two quite recent examples that I hope help you understand what we're trying to say in our evidence.
It does, and what you've also said in your submission is that we need a strong advocate with powers and duties to ensure their prominence in policy development and delivery of the national outcomes. So what sort of powers and duties would this individual have?
Yeah. So we are attracted to the model in Wales, as many people in Scotland are at the moment, because as we have seen, the Welsh legislation and the Scottish legislation came into force at a very similar time, but have had very different success rates in terms of implementation. And one of the factors that has been put down to is the existence of a wellbeing commissioner and an office for that. Now, actually, what is underneath that is the Commissioner's ability to request information, and a very strong memorandum of understanding between the Commissioner for Future Generations and Audit Wales to pull together the powers of both organisations for maximum scrutiny impact. So it is not merely that they produce an annual report, as is expected in Scotland, or that they produce research. They also use powers to request information to hold public to account Welsh public services and bodies for delivering on their national outcomes. And we are missing that key accountability route. So we know in the Scottish legislation that public bodies have to have regard to the national outcomes, but there is no mechanism in Scottish legislation to hold them accountable for having regard to the national outcomes. Now, I think the other sort of interesting and important point in that is that in the Welsh model, the accountability is not for delivering improvements to the national outcomes. It is for having processes in place that show how they are trying to have regard to the national outcomes and the goals in the work that they are doing. So the accountability is a process-level accountability to show how they're trying to change their ways of working, not an accountability for a set of indicators, which quite rightly many organisations say they cannot be held solely accountable for. So there's a complexity there, but we think it would be quite helpful in a Scottish context to learn from the Welsh experience.
Okay, thank you for that. And Dr. Elliott, you are nodding vigorously there. I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on that. And also, if you could touch on the issue of the strategic state, which you mentioned the word strategic in response to the first question. You obviously talked about the strategic state in your submission, so I'm just wondering if you can expand on that.
Just to pick up on something that Max had said, I completely agree with what he had said, and I think there's a risk in looking at the MPF again that the decisions taken to change the indicators or change the outcomes or do something like that. And I think it's really important for this committee and for others who are involved to consider that implementation gap and to consider how to implement the framework that we already have, rather than necessarily making some sort of radical reform of that and spending years of time coming up with a new framework, rather than actually considering, well, how do we actually make this happen in practice? And what Jen has said around the focus on process, I think, is really important as well, because this was never, in its original iteration, this wasn't intended to be a kind of performance measurement framework. It wasn't intended to be, counting specific indicators in that way. It was something that was meant to be more of a, what I would say, is a decision-making tool. To get people to think more strategically and also, importantly, more collaboratively across different directorates within the government, but also beyond the government as well. And that's where this idea of the strategic state comes about. I mean, that's something that's come about from the OECD originally. And my research is really looking at how the Scottish government's approach to the MPF is quite closely aligned with what the OECD consider to be this idea of a strategic state. So that's where that concept comes about. So I do think it's important that we don't spend too much focus on measuring indicators, but thinking about that process. And again, you know, if you think about things like the UN Sustainable Development Goals, in a similar way, it's a similar kind of philosophy. They're not intended to be tick box exercises, and the UN aren't expecting that all 193 countries are going to, you know, measure against every single one of the goals. But they're meant to be kind of stretching ambitions, you know, and the expectation is that people will be making progress towards those goals, and it's how you demonstrate how you're making that progress and what steps you're taking to do that in the way that, that Jen has described, thinking about the processes rather than that kind of granular detail of specific measurement of things. So I would say that's quite an important factor to take into account as well.
Okay, and Dr. French, you've said in your submission there's a lot of evidence the NPF has been meaningfully incorporated in the organisational routines within these organisations or in changing decisions, promoting learning or altering policies. So how can we ensure that that does actually take place?
Well, there's probably a few things that we need to do in order to achieve that. I think a lot of learning can be taken from Wales. It's the combination of statutory duties, scrutiny, accountability, as a lot of the submissions to this inquiry have kind of reinforced. But it's also building on some of the strengths that that surrounded the MPF and some of the Scottish Government's work on that, which is positioning this as a kind of holistic societal approach with broad ownership that kind of galvanises people and excites people, makes them want to engage. I think from Wales, the learning is if you strap on additional duties in a new bill that would force public bodies to plan for, promote, set objectives and account for those objectives, they can choose to do that in a very passive, sort of superficial way if they're so inclined. But actually, if they're encouraged to do that through a supportive package of and supportive challenge through a commissioner or an auditor, an inspection body, and also to see the value in that duty in promoting their own objectives. So a local community planning partnership setting a LOIP that sees the NPF as promoting its own agenda and being important in that regard. You need the will as well as the duties in order to get effectiveness. Otherwise, I think you get lip service to those indicators and to those duties. I think you see that in Northern Ireland, the government departments that have really gone for their outcomes-based accountability approach are the ones that wanted to, and the ones that saw the value in it, and the ones that saw that their own ownership of that reflected in their contribution. If they wanted to, they could do it as a very passive reporting mechanism and not really, you know, do that strategising that Ian's talked about. So yes. I think both of those things are important.
Yeah, I mean, so yes, you've talked about galvanising stories which capture the public interest and communicate its values rather than merely list statistics in your section on soft power and hard power strategies. So yeah. I just wonder if you can talk us through a wee bit of that.
Well, what I think I mean by that is that the MPF in some way needs to connect with the public interest, but also it connects with media interest and parliamentary interest. So it needs to connect with the stories that people want to tell. Statistics showing indicators going up and down and staying the same, even in aggregate, don't really capture the public interest. Scotland Performs has had historically low engagement rates from the public and very little uptake in the media. And again, if we compare it to Wales, the Commissioner has produced guidance for parliamentary members and also for media organisations so that if they want to tell a story about Wales Act and their national outcomes and indicators, then they can do that and they can be provided with the guidance and the structures and the scaffolding that enables them to do that. Pure performance measures are historically low interest in the public, except if they're accompanied by a narrative which explains why those are important.
Okay, just my last final question for you before opening out the session, that's to yourself, Ms. Wallace, which is about We were in Dundee last week, although there was a lot of energy enthusiasm for the NPF. There was one individual said to me that the problem we have with the NPF is that it's yet another series of things that government expect us to do, and we spend a lot of time having meetings thinking about, you know, we've got this set of objectives, we've got that set of objectives, we've got this, and they can be overlapping, they can be kind of not quite contradictory, but there's a huge amount of energy and resource seems to be taken up saying, well, what do we prioritise? So how do we cut through that, you know, through the Gordian knot of all these different kind of objectives that are being put on local authorities and other organisations, for example, so that people can see more clearly and effectively help progress the aims of the NPF.
Thank you, and I would recognise that experience that the person in Dundee was describing, and certainly in the conversations and what we have reviewed, there are many instances of the duties to provide statistics landing on officers within local government who have to furnish the information for these plans to be produced. I think in one local authority, and COSLA will be better placed to do this, but one local authority reported to us that there were 9 separate plans related to the same thing, in that case about children and young people. My favourite quote on this, again, is from Wales. The Auditor-General in Wales said, we need a radical decluttering. And I think after a generation of legislation in Scotland, we also need a radical decluttering. We're very good as a nation in adding on additional duties, and particularly additional duties to create a plan. But we need a process to assess all of those now and to assess actually which is the most important. I think one of the... I hesitate to say failures, but one of the disappointments in the Community Empowerment Act when it created the national outcomes was that they did not in any sense sit above that sense of the plans and the frameworks and the other activities. So quite often when you see them referenced, you actually see them referenced at the bottom rather than at the top. You know, so in the flow, yeah, it feels very much like they are an afterthought rather than being the thing which departments and agencies can hook their activity onto. So it's a retrofitting rather than an analysis from the outset. So a radical decluttering is probably required in Scotland, and a process to do that effectively in consultation with the many people who work for the benefit of Scotland, and then an exploration of how do you create a system that shows very clearly that the national outcomes are meant to sit at the top of that run of plans and frameworks and not as an afterthought.
I'm a big fan of decluttering, I must say. Anyway, we'll now open up to the colleagues around the table, and the first person to ask questions will be Daniel, to be followed by Ross.
Yeah, I like that phrase, radical decluttering. It sounds like what I'm constantly being told to do at home. I'm very interested by the conversation so far, and I'd like to just pick up on a couple of different points. And I think there's a... structure seems to be the thread that runs through this, and at a number of different levels. But I'd like to start with Dr. Ian Elliott. You were talking about National Performance Framework originally being a decision-making tool. But when I actually look at it and you step through the outcomes and indicators, the outcomes are relatively straightforward to understand. The indicators, you suddenly just get landed with a sea of bullet points that don't immediately, you know, are difficult to sort of intuitively see what they're trying to tell you, or even whether that's one thing or a number of different things. And actually, if you step through, so I was just looking at the children's happiness, and actually it turns out that is just one thing, that's one survey that measures, you know, 4 quite narrow metrics, which are valuable, but not necessarily entirely encompassing what I think we'd all understand to be children's happiness. So is one of the problems here the structure of the NPF itself, in that we have very good high-level outcomes and then actually a kind of a quite asymmetrical set of indicators that sit below it, and none of which are kind of intuitively easy to understand what they're telling you? And is the NPF too difficult to use in its current structure?
There's a big issue with focusing on metrics and measuring metrics within what is essentially a complex system that many different agencies and government bodies and third sector bodies are all working towards. And that's where I think we get into these issues that I was describing in terms of thinking about it as a performance measurement tool, that it becomes actually quite problematic. And I know Max has done quite a lot of research on that as well, in terms of some of the issues with having a very metrics-based approach. And that was what I was meaning in terms of the reforms that were brought in way back now in 2008 were really about trying to get the Scottish Government to think on a more strategic basis. And it was very much for the internal government at that time. And there was quite a lot of leadership around that and quite a lot of leadership development. Just picking up on some of the things that have been mentioned in terms of Wales, I do think that is a really interesting example to look at, which I've referred to numerous times, particularly, you know, that they have Academy Wales, which does a lot of leadership development activity, and they've got really strong links between the government there and academia, the Welsh Centre for Public Policy being an example of a really strong research unit that helps underpin a lot of that work and provides some of that scrutiny. I mean, I'm not sure about the idea of the commissioner. I'm not as familiar with that, I must admit. But I think, you know, there's certainly a role for Audit Scotland in some of this work, and I can see how they're starting to enter into this space more, which is really encouraging. But also, you know, arguably for committees as well, for all committees, not just this committee, but for all committees to really consider how the work of the Scottish Government is being scrutinised in relation to the performance framework and in relation to those outcomes, rather than the kind of, as you're pointing to, the kind of granular detail of specific indicators.
Thank you. Dr. French, picking up on that, but if I could just also ask you, I mean, is there a sense in which the metrics need to be split apart from the capturing of the outcomes? And this, I mean, and why I say that is twofold. One is, I mean, I accept what Dr. Elliott is saying there. However, if you just had, you know, qualitative outcomes with absolutely no measurement of them, again, I think we'd have a problem. And then the other, I mean, I'll just relay something that was said at the focus group that I was at in Glasgow. We had parallel ones in Dundee and Glasgow, which was that a sense which we're not using data properly. You know, we've got very narrow metrics. We're actually, you know, in the world we're in the 21st century, it's about, you know, big data sets and you know, much more sort of richer data analysis. So do we need to, A, split apart the capturing of the outcomes from the measurement, and do we need to sort of overhaul actually how we're conceiving of what that measurement looks like to sort of capture that 21st century sort of big data approach that's available to us?
Well, I think one of the big problems with the MPF is it's a robust framework. Internationally, comparatively speaking, it has a lot of documentation, statistical backing, and some sort of agreement of whether an indicator is going up or down. And there's been a lot of work done within the Scottish Government on getting the statistics right. I think it's a robust framework, but I don't think it's an accessible framework. I think it's hard for people to see what role they can play within this framework. So if this is presented to a community planning manager, when they begin to think about the construction of a LOIP or a locality plan, it's very difficult to see how that can relate to local manners. Much easier to consult with the Improvement Service, who have more localised measures and who have better working experience with councils and with local organisations. So The accessibility for me is less to do with the indicators and outcomes. I think indicators have to feed into outcomes. There has to be some way of making sense of movement in the outcomes, and that will always be that will come about with trade-offs and with uncertainties around the measurement. It's never going to be perfectly objective, and that's fine. One thing that the MPF doesn't have, it has values, and they're good in a multilateral, cross-sectoral setting. It doesn't have ways of working. One of the things that's been really effective, I think, in Wales in the scrutiny context is they have a set of ways of working which are going to elude me, but they include things like collaboration, participation, long-term focus, things that we know that if you're taking an outcomes focus and a focus on well-being, on collective well-being, these are essential principles that you adopt. And that has proved much more effective in galvanising some of the practical actions that are taken, both in the planning, the strategising that Dr. Elliott was talking about in government and out with government, but also in the scrutiny functions. Much easier to look back and see whether the quality of long-term planning has been there and whether the actions have lived up to the ambitions over a long term, a five-year period, for instance. So I think that layer is sort of missing. I mean, it would seem to me a perfect opportunity to kind of revise and reintroduce the Christie principles, the pillars, which align very well to Wales, that some of these practical guidance that organisations can access and can relate to their own context. The other thing I would say on that matter is high-level outcomes frameworks need a process of localization to make them relevant locally. There needs to be a process of really taking stock of the indicators and the outcomes and coming up with a valid stretching interpretation of that, what that means to a local context. How we've done aligned frameworks in government, like there's a justice outcomes framework, there's a children's wellbeing outcomes framework, there's what's it, health and social care. The alignment is done after the fact, so we come up with our outcomes and we say, well, that one's related to that NP, that national outcome, that one's related to that other national outcome. There's really done after the fact rather than at the beginning and ensuring that the alignment runs through it. So I would say there's a few things that could be done to make the NPF more accessible and more legible, particularly as it moves to a whole society context. The other thing I would say, just very quickly, is the focus on measurement can't be done at the expense of a focus on implementation. It would be, I think, a missed opportunity if this review, this national review, the statutory review, focuses just on the measures and the technical elements of this. It's a difficult problem, but it's difficult in a straightforward way.
Can I just ask you for a clarification? When you're saying about making it more accessible, and then also in terms of what you were saying there, in terms of there seemed to almost be a point there about interpretation, and I wonder if what you're saying is actually there needs to be both a government-wide level, but then an individual sort of, whether it's a directorate or agency level, an almost interpretation of how outcomes are going to be influenced. Because it does strike me that you bring two people together and they'll have completely different ideas actually what will impact those outcomes. And unless you actually have a stated, you know, view as to how those outcomes are going to be implemented, you're not actually going to get any consensus at all. Is that a fair sort of interpretation of what you're
saying?
It's
fair. I would use, instead of interpretation, a negotiation.
Right.
So a meeting of parties that incorporates both interests and comes to a formalised agreement. So that might mean that some local measures are important, but it might mean that some national indicators also take precedence, and that is an agreement that's set out at the outset.
So finally, Ms Wallace, I'd just like to come to you. I mean, I was struck by your written submission where you were saying that the processes for implementing the National Forum Forums are weak. I mean, ultimately, I wonder if we're sort of dancing around the issue here. I mean, and I think it's good to talk about processes, good to talk about agencies. Does it not actually come down to individuals? Do we not need to actually put people on the spot and make them accountable for delivering these things? Because it's very much, in terms of our conversations, there's a sense in which it's almost voluntary, you know, for both individuals and agencies as to how they're electing to play their part in the national framework. Do we need to have cabinet secretaries and ministers reporting against this, directorates and agencies, and make that much more explicit?
And if we were looking at overhauling the Community Empowerment Act legislation and putting in place a robust piece of legislation that did that, that is precisely the type of thing that you would do. So you would follow through the process to say, well, you know, we are going to require these agencies to have regard to this, and then we are going to nominate who they have to be accountable to for having regard, and that is the piece that is missing. I think we are saying that you can do that in a number of ways. That could be to the whole of Parliament, it could be to specific committees, it could be to commissioners' office or to Audit Scotland. But at the moment, in the absence of that, while it's not voluntary, because it is a statutory obligation on them, it feels voluntary. because nobody is asking them, as you say, to report on it. So I think that is the gap, which is quite often expressed in terms of an accountability gap, because people are then, you know, sort of interested in the relationships. The perception of that then becomes, but you can't make us accountable for outcomes. And that's where we lose some of the conversation about what's actually possible here, because we all understand in a complex society that a linear accountability for outcomes is neither possible nor desirable. So we're trying to find a way through this to hold people accountable for the bit that they actually can be responsible for, which is in terms of how they are having regard to explaining how they are changing their behaviours in light of the information coming through the national outcomes and the national indicators, so that we can see that golden thread.
And is that where sort of an agreement might come into play, where it, rather than it just sort of assigning an outcome or area to an individual, actually you've got agreements that explain the contribution to it? Yeah,
absolutely. So you would say within an agency, you know, it may not be possible with an agency or at local government to have action across all of the outcomes. It may not be desirable to be doing that, but an agreement to say, actually, we're going to focus on these three outcome areas and this is how they're related and this is who we will work with to make that happen, would be a conscious step forward from where we are now, where so much of the change process is put on individual culture change, you know, rather than externalising that and trying to change the structures that create the cultural behaviours in the first place.
Thank you very much. My understanding of this is considerably decluttered from when I started from.
Thank you, Daniel. Ross, to be followed by John.
Thanks. The group of individuals that Daniel and I met with last week in governing the organisations that they represented began to coalesce around the word implicit when we were asking them about the alignment between their organisation's strategic plan and the NPF. So if I could start with a relatively general question to Jennifer in the first instance, is it fair to say that at the moment the NPF is operating more like a set of general principles that shape public sector culture in Scotland than a specific set of measurable outcomes?
I'm not sure I would use the word principle, but I think the principle of working towards outcomes is in place. So the idea that there is an agreement within Scotland that we need to collaborate more, that we need more joined up working, and that we are doing that in order to improve the lives of the people that we serve is well understood. In that. The process underneath that for how you transform that set of, you know, sort of ambitions into something that an organisation can do, there is not a sense of shared understanding or agreement on that, or guidance or strong case studies or the types of things that people would actually be able to assess whether or not that was important for their organisation. So in terms of the, you know, is the culture of Scottish civic society and public services, as I see it, working in that direction? Yes, you know, that is what they're trying to do, but I think they're doing it without much of a shared sense or a clear sense of how to do it.
Thanks. And Ian, if I could ask you, you mentioned in your submission that administrative leadership around the NPF has diminished over time, and you've alluded to that a little bit already this morning, but could you go into a little bit more detail on who you're referring to there and why that's been the case?
Yeah, and that picks up as well on something that Daniel was saying and Jennifer earlier about accountability. Where does accountability lie? And certainly when it was first established, there was that clear sense of leadership and ownership within the Scottish Government. But what I've found more recently in speaking to people is there's a degree of confusion as to who actually owns the National Performance Framework. And it's been curious speaking to people, and some people will say that it's the Permanent Secretary, some people will identify a particular Director General, some people will identify a particular Cabinet Secretary, other people will say the Scottish Leaders Forum, and some people just say, well, I've no idea. And there does seem to be that lack of really clear ownership and leadership, which was there previously. And I think that, for me, that's one of the key fundamental lessons that needs to be taken away from this process of review, is that there needs to be sustained leadership in order to really make this effective. We need the sustained leadership and the focus on implementation. We need to, you know, close off that gap, that implementation gap. But you need the sustained leadership in order to have that, you know, identifiable accountability, and in order for people to see that this is something that is, you know, going to last, is going to be around a long time. It is something that people need to take into account, and you know, they need to recognise it explicitly in their plans and so on. And that, I think, is something that has diminished over time. That's certainly what I found through through the research that I've done.
So when it was there previously, where was that leadership coming from? Was it the Permanent Secretary, or was it Director Generals?
Well, I mean, going way back, and apologies for the slight history lesson here, but going way back to 2008, it was ultimately the Permanent Secretary who developed the performance framework, and you know, certainly there were ministers who were, you know, particularly keen champions of it at the time. John Swinney, someone who's been mentioned numerous times in terms of providing leadership in the political side for development of this, but certainly it was the Permanent Secretary as well, John Elvidge, at the time. And going through to 2015 and the Community Empowerment Act, I think it's fair to say that quite a few people who I've interviewed have spoken about Peter Housden's approach to the performance framework, and having, he certainly had more of a delivery focus in terms of how he provided leadership to that, and Derek Mackay, who was the Finance Secretary at the time as well, had certainly a key role to play in that, and the Scottish Leaders Forum as well, you know, collectively. But I think, as I say, over time, you know, arguably it's events that have kind of, you know, taken focus away, but there has been a sense of a lack of focus, particularly within the Scottish Government. And that may be, you know, as it's shifted from being a government approach to being much more of a whole of society approach, well, who owns it if it's a whole of society approach? I think that's one of the unanswered questions. Where does the ownership lie if it's suddenly everybody's responsibility and everybody's accountable for it? That may be something that a commissioner could help to you know, unravel, or you know, other bodies like Audit Scotland, for example. But there does need to be, I think, that central focus in order to provide that place where people can see that it is being led from a particular area. I think that is important in terms of that, you know, putting it in people's minds. I think Jen maybe can add to that. Yeah.
If it's okay, just to add another piece of information. Again, apologies for the history here. Ian and I have been involved in this for some time. There was, for a number of years, a Cabinet Secretary roundtable on the National Performance Framework, which was cross-party, which was convened in this building with members of all the parties, and it had oversight. That was actually the body, the parliamentary piece, that had oversight of the development of the first round of national outcomes and the indicators, and it met with a number of external stakeholders representing different interests. It has not met since 2018. It had no statutory reason for meeting. It had no real place within the structures of Parliament. You know, it was something that was done because at that time Mr. Swinney and then Mr. Mackay, I believe, were committed to it and wanted it to meet. But in the absence of that, there has not been a space where the parliamentarians have been able to explore that in the way that they were able to under that round table. So there is a very clear change at that point in 2018 where you can see that lack of impetus and external engagement happening.
Thanks. And sticking with this question of leadership and ownership, Max, you made an interesting comparison in your submission between the Scottish model of appointing champions for various outcomes within the civil service as opposed to Northern Ireland, where there was more defined owners. But you also noted there's quite significant levels of internal opposition in Northern Ireland within the public sector. Are those two things related?
Which two things, sorry?
The model of appointing owners rather than champions in Northern Ireland, so you've got that very direct accountability. Has that contributed to that internal opposition, or are they unrelated issues?
Yes, and I mean, this comes back to the accountability point. So there was an expectation in the Northern Irish Civil Service that permanent secretaries and senior civil servants were going to be held to account at some stage through a likely a parliamentary process to account for movement in national indicators. So there's an expectation that there was some sort of accountability on the horizon. So this surfaced sort of fears of being held to account for things that you can't control, you know, the perennial problem with outcomes-based accountability. And so how this was sort of managed was broadly, there was some sort of relational kind of collaboration amongst the sort of senior civil servants around this approach. But broadly, it was a top-down imposition. And there was, at that time, as there is now, either there was uncertainty or discomfort around these uncertain accountability relations, or there was dislike of the approach or being forced to sort of take account of different measures. There was buy-in at certain in certain sections of civil service leadership and not in others. Had a very conducive head of the civil service at that point. And that subsequently changed. But really, this didn't broaden into a kind of collective endeavour. So there was there were struggles to sort of make the technical elements of that work. So the decision was made to assign national indicators which were the closest to the domains that civil servants were working in. It's only fair if you're going to be held to account that it's in your area. But consequently, that, if anything, entrenched the sort of silo mentality. Here's my indicator and I don't take account of other ones. So that linear attributional approach, I would say, worked sort of against this endeavour to work across departments in Northern Ireland, which is difficult for a whole host of cultural and statutory reasons. That was where some of the opposition kind of emerged from. And then when the executive collapsed in 2017, many elements of that outcomes-based approach kind of fell by the wayside, and there was the opportunity to disengage and then to establish a resistance, really, to it being reintroduced. You know, we don't want to go back to that sort of system. And then there was leadership changeover, the head of civil service and such forth. It lost its champions. And now that's, I would say, a difficult challenge for the Northern Irish government, the executive office and the civil service to be working with just now.
Thanks very much. I've just got one final brief question. You mentioned again in your written submission that parliamentary scrutiny in Scotland using the outcomes was an example of good practice. Now, I'll be honest, most, if not all of us, did not think we were doing a good job of this.
Indeed.
So could you tell us what we were doing right? Because to be honest, we weren't aware of that.
Well, I mean, comparatively speaking, national outcomes and indicators are used more in the Scottish Parliament than they are in the Welsh Senate or in the Northern Irish Assembly. Statistically speaking, you know, mentions of the national outcomes, for instance, are used more often. There's a few caveats to that. One significant thing is, in Scotland, one of the real benefits here is that we have an MPF which has a degree of solidity and recognition that the national outcomes and indicators in Wales or Northern Ireland don't have. In Wales, they talk about their act. They don't talk about their well-being goals or the well-being indicators or their milestones. So the MPF has a kind of solidity, albeit one which is rightly challenged on a number of accounts, but it has that maybe gets it in the minds of parliamentarians, but also clerks, research staff in the Parliament. I mean, when members reconvened for this parliamentary session, my understanding is you were briefed on here's what the national outcomes are, here's the indicators, here you might be able to use them. So they've been used in different parliamentary committees, is my understanding, than they were in the prior session. So there's maybe some movement, some indicators, some indicator of greater usage. But I would say also, you might be feeling like how you use this framework as a parliamentarian, just as a community planning manager, as a department head in a government department, how you use it can feel very difficult to access.
Thanks, Ross. I'm quite reassured.
Thanks, Ross. John, to be followed by Liz.
Thanks, convener. Yes, hopefully following on a bit from some of that, the question of language and how important language is. I mean, we had various people, when we spoke to some of the government officials, they talked about language is intangible for outsiders. And I think it was the Citizens Advice talked about the language differing, but they felt that they were broadly lined up. They said their own language is different, differs from the language of national outcomes. The two are broadly aligned. And then I'm looking at your, Dr. French, one of your points, which is we should rebrand the National Performance Framework as Scotland's National Wellbeing Framework. So I'm just wondering how important it is that we have the wording right, and should we be changing some of the wording?
Well, two reasons for that. One is technical. You've already got an NPF, and it might be given more cognizance in the Scottish Government than our current one, with the National Planning Framework. So there's a technical point, but also the larger and more significant point is the branding of this is, I would say, a crucial part to getting it right. A national performance framework doesn't excite people as much as a national wellbeing framework. A performance framework is something that an organisation uses to regulate its processes. I would say a national wellbeing framework would link with the galvanising interest nationally and internationally around collective wellbeing as a kind of organising principle for society. I think that's something that has attracted cross-party support and links with a developing kind of international agenda, which has a real relevance for people locally and working in public bodies. I think Jen can maybe give a bit more fleshing out on that. But I think the point I would make is the branding and the positioning is crucial to the life or death of a performance framework. It has to excite people. A wellbeing framework excites people more than a performance framework.
I mean, I'll just come to Ms. Walls in a minute, but I mean, just to kind of pursue that, I mean, do you think, because I feel that we don't talk about the National Performance Framework very much, and although maybe MSPs have been briefed about it, you know, I don't see it coming up very much in the Chamber or in committee specifically being mentioned. So do you think, I mean, is that the experience in Wales and elsewhere, that if the words are better, that people will use them more?
Well, in Wales, well-being within their Future Generations, the Wellbeing for Future Generations Act, has established a real kind of cultural significance. Policy-making kind of takes stock and takes note of that as a matter of course. And that has kind of galvanised a vision that is long-term, that is societal, that's cross-party, and that's really influenced the kind of discourse. And has exerted some of that kind of cultural impact through the language that it's used. It couldn't have got to that point if it had used different words or if it stuck with a kind of performance focus. Really articulating that kind of collective aspiration that people can get involved with, that they want to engage with, and eventually that they can't not engage with, should be one of the aims, I would say, of an implementation strategy for the NPF or the NWF.
Okay, thanks. We'll work on that. Ms. Wallace?
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, this is something that at Carnegie UK we're really interested in, is, you know, how do you take these concepts of social progress and translate them into things that people can understand and act around and convene around? And, I mean, generally we find that people can convene and bring a huge wealth of lived experience and professional experience to a conversation around wellbeing. So they are able to engage with that in a way that other more technical language they are less likely to be able to engage with. As Max has said, you know, we don't really believe that the National Performance Framework is a performance framework in the classic, you know, approach of that. It is not a linear process to identify an A to B of how you improve your performance. So it is, it's antiquated. It's historic about where it came from. And it really, you know, it could be due a refresh, for example. Now, we've been arguing that for a number of years. The Scottish Government themselves seem very committed to using the word performance, and we're not entirely sure why that is. We've said, you know, you could call it the National Progress Framework. That would work. You know, you could still call it an NPF. you know, despite the problems with the national planning framework. And again, that's, you know, that's not something that they've been willing to take forward. But we believe it is a significant barrier to the wider societal use of the framework, because people outside of core Scottish Government do not see themselves as having a role to play within a performance framework, and they don't feel that they have evidence to give to the development of a performance framework. Whereas if you ask them, do they have evidence about how we can all live well together, how we can all work together for a better Scotland, they have plenty of evidence to bring into that conversation. So it's part of that opening up to try to brand it in a way that really accentuates the value that we all have to bring to it. I mean, in terms of, you know, the extent to which you can engage the public in statistics, there is a difficulty with the number of statistics, you know, and the way that that is, you know, sort of presented on a website. And again, at Carnegie, we have experimented with summary statistics of what we call gross domestic wellbeing, and that's for English data rather than Scottish data, as it was an exploratory programme, really. But again, the message is that, you know, when you process the information in a way that is geared to communicate with the public, they will engage with it, you know, and you need to separate out which bit of this is about communicating with the public about how we're doing as a nation, and which bit of it is about communicating with managers in terms of how they make decisions, or indeed with politicians, but how they make decisions about public finances and how to hold people to account. And at the moment, the framework looks and feels too much in one direction rather than the other.
I mean, I'm interested in this use of the word performance, and that there seems to be, you know, you're quite critical of it and others seem to want to keep it. I mean, is it because it's performance suggests we can measure things like the performance of a car, or, you know, it's you know, 99, 100, 98, whatever the figure happens to be, performance suggests we can measure and we can hold government to account or hold someone to account, whereas well-being is a vaguer word?
First of all, the science of well-being has grown massively over the past 10 years, you know, so actually just in terms of how we can identify actions that would improve well-being, you know, there's a significant body of research and evidence on that now. But in terms of the outcome element of it, a performance framework gives the impression of there being a linear relationship that you can attribute the change to the action that was carried out. Now, you can do that in some public services, you can do that in some interventions, you can do that. But when the outcome is, for example, improving children and young people's well-being or improving their lives, that is not an A to B thing that you can create an attribution chain. What you can do is say, we are making a contribution to that outcome. So by delivering high quality education, we know that there is enough evidence that says high quality education improves children's feelings of well-being and their external objective indicators of well-being. So we can make that chain. But we're not saying that an education department is specifically responsible to create the entire benefit of well-being through that one line of accountability and through that direct attribution. And that's where it differs from a traditional performance approach, where you would create a much smaller link between your activity and your indicator, and you would be able to say, yes, we did, we moved from A to B on this. But the chain is much, much broader in an outcomes framework.
I mean, the Parliament tends to question how many people have got hires, how many people have got degrees, how many are at college, these very fixed things, rather than how's the well-being going.
Yeah. So the point of intervention would be, what do those indicators actually map onto what we know gives people a good life? Or is something changing within that? So is there a change in the evidence that says actually having a degree is no longer a guarantee to having a good income? And are we therefore using those indicators, so those are output indicators, as proxy measures of a good life when they no longer hold true? And that's where you want to come in and put the scrutiny role in. Say, well, does this indicator act as an outcome indicator? Is it a proxy indicator? And is it a relevant indicator to the current times that we're living in?
Okay. Dr. Elliott, I haven't asked you anything. Did you want to come in on any of that? Or?
Well, the performance word is, I think, a bit of a problem. I think, you know, it can be perceived as being a punitive thing as soon as you say that it's about performance. And it can also be very much perceived as top-down as well, that this is, you know, that an individual charity or an individual local authority is being, you know, held to account by the Scottish Government. And again, that's not really how it was, I think, originally intended. And so this idea of a well-being framework, I think, you know, there's a lot of merit to that. I suppose perhaps one of the challenges to that is around the value for money duty and how we demonstrate value for money if there isn't that clear link between this spending going to this particular initiative with this particular outcome. So there is I can see why the Scottish Government are keen on the idea of performance. I can see where that comes from. I'm just not sure that the National Performance Framework is the right tool to do some of that activity. And I think, you know, the idea of a well-being framework, you know, has a lot of merit in trying to develop a different mindset and actually a more collaborative approach.
Okay, I mean, that ties in quite well with what I was just going to ask next, which was about the budget, which I think, Ms Wallace, you've mentioned as well. And there's been comment too from government officials that really they don't see the National Performance Framework being used in the budget process. So are you kind of saying that's not necessarily a bad thing, or should this and the budget, the National Performance Framework and the budget, be a bit more closely tied together?
Well, what I would say about that is over time there has been more ring fencing of budgets, particularly to local government, and that in itself has proven to be problematic. So I would caution against seeing this review as, you know, an opportunity to you know, do more directive approaches to service delivery and to, you know, ring fence budgets around that. That really hasn't proven to be particularly successful in terms of delivering on the outcomes. So I think there needs to be some caution around how it's used in that way.
But would you then end up with a situation where instead of the government saying, well, we've got to have 1,140 hours for childcare, that some councils would say, well, we'll use the National Performance Framework, so we'll have 1,000 or we'll have 1,200 or we'll have 900, and it would be a very varied picture around the country? Would that be a bad thing, or would that be okay?
Well, I suppose we have local government so that local government is accountable to local communities, don't we? So it's really up to communities. And I think that's where, you know, we're supposed to be. It's embedded within the Empowerment Act, the Community Empowerment Act. Where are communities in all of this? How do communities decide what's important to them? Where do they feed into this process? You know, again, the more top-down you make it, the less you're actually empowering communities, the less you're doing that work. So again, I would caution against any directive approach, and I don't think that would be in line with either the Christie Commission principles or indeed the principles of the Community Empowerment Act.
Okay, Ms Wallace, can I come back to you, because you mentioned, I think, in relation to budgeting for children's wellbeing, about how the budget and the NPF tie together. Do you want to?
Thank you. So I think the first thing worth noting on wellbeing budgets is that this is a very new area of international activity for governments, and there are very few governments who are experimenting with this. So everything is being done in real time, you know, learning from practice in other countries and learning from colleagues at the OECD who are applying their own resources to understanding it. There's not a core set of principles for a wellbeing budget that you can apply. So what I'm going to say needs to be within that context, you know. That is difficult. The analysis that Dr. Trebek did for us on children's budgeting was, again, that where the national outcomes come in, they are very much an afterthought. They are a process at the end of a budgetary process rather than at the start of it. And what she meant by that, and what we have explored with others since her work, is that there is not an initial assessment of how people in Scotland are doing against the national outcomes that then begins the process of where we should spend money. It goes the other way around. What are we spending money on, and where can we spend a little bit more money or a little bit less money? And then exploring that in relationship to the national outcomes or the national indicators. A full wellbeing approach, whether for a portion of the population, as we were arguing for children and young people, or for the whole population, would turn the whole process completely on its head. It would take a considerable number of years to do it. So we speak to colleagues in New Zealand, and they have done a partial wellbeing budget. And they would describe it themselves as the first step, probably on a 10-year process of trying to turn their budget around from where they are now to being one that is fully based on an assessment of, as they call it, their living standards framework. But they are doing that consciously. They know it's a 10-year process and they are improving every year. Whereas the approach in Scotland is much more to, well, you know, we want to do something, you know, and this is something that we are able to do this year, you know, and therefore they are, you know, they are applying the language and some of the processes around wellbeing onto pre-existing budgets without that long-term plan of how they're going to get from where we are now to a better quality outcome-based budget for the future.
OK, thanks. And we could explore that longer, but I'll leave that to convener. Thanks.
Apologies, Liz, to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you and good morning. I wonder if I can explore two themes, the first of which is based on some comments that were made to us. I can't quote the names because it was a private session last week, but it did include very senior officials within local government and within some of the third sector. And they all agreed that the National Performance Framework in principle is a good thing, but some of the adjectives used to describe its workability were, and I quote, ethereal, anodyne, top-heavy and theoretical. And a couple of people added that they didn't feel that it was necessary to have the National Performance Framework because if they were doing their job properly, they should be doing the things that have already been set out. And I thought that was quite an interesting comment about the reflections from people within local government who are on the front line of, you know, having to put into practice a lot of policies. And we were particularly talking about improvements in addressing the children's poverty issue in Dundee. And I wonder how you respond to that, because it picks up a comment, Dr. Elliott, that you made about the principles of the Christie Commission and what's supposed to be happening here is that if we're really going to get better outcomes and better well-being, is it not something that we should be doing through local initiatives because they're the ones who know best what's working well within their local community, rather than having this big, I think, Ms. Wallace, you described it as scaffolding, that there is this sort of dilemma between too much on a sort of very general national framework, but actually what we really want are things that are working very, very well locally. Could you just give us your reflections on that?
Thank you. There was a lot in that, so if I try and formulate my thoughts. So I think, first of all, shouldn't they be doing it anyway? And aren't they doing it anyway? I think the evidence suggests that, yes, in terms of their work to improve a particular outcome, but not their work to improve a range of outcomes. So it comes back to the Christie conversations about how do we create collaborative and joined up public services. If we are where a number of commentators and other organisations believe we are, where we have got to diminishing returns on being able to work in detailed silos to improve people's lives, and the next set of improvements will come from joining up, finding the connections between public health and education and, you know, active travel and so on to make all of our lives better, then we need to be able to work across those silos, a little bit the way that Dr. French was describing was so problematic in Northern Ireland. And no, they are not, the evidence is that they are not able to do that because there are structural barriers to them doing that. What we've done is create a performance framework that is trying to overcome those barriers and not really given it the tools to allow it to do that heavy lifting. And that's what I mean by the scaffolding. So what else does it need in order to help it deliver that? In terms of the theoretical, I mean, we sometimes get this referenced as the motherhood and apple pie response to a wellbeing framework. Is it not all blindingly obvious that that's what we... Well, yes, it is. You know, and actually, you know, if you look across, as I've had the great pleasure of doing, you know, sort of multiple government frameworks, they're all remarkably similar. You know, and Scotland's does not stand out particularly differently from that. You know, it has a value statement, which we believe is incredibly important about who we are right now as the people of Scotland, and that is important, and that sets it apart from the others. But when you actually look at the content, there's very little difference there. But what it is trying to do is articulate a vision and a space for whatever country is using the wellbeing framework that says this is what we're trying to achieve, this is who we believe ourselves to be, and this is what we are going to organise around. It is very specifically focused on trying to get away from a model of trickle-down economics that says that if we just focus on the economy, everything else will get on better. And most of the literature comes from that background. It says, you know, the economy is not the answer to all of our problems, or certainly GDP growth is not the answer to all of our problems. We need other things to happen. And that is a particularly important message from the environmental stakeholders, I'm sure many of whom will have submitted to this inquiry as well. So, in terms of the issues around implementation, I think the problem is that the story isn't really very well told about what we're asking people to do. So they can gather around the general concept, but the guidance on what they're being asked to do differently just doesn't exist. And I think if we were able to give people more of that guidance, it would help resolve those issues.
And just to pick up on that point, can that be localised? Because they were very, very clear in a couple of the groups that I was speaking to that they wanted more local autonomy to decide on what was doing the best thing for in terms of wellbeing for their area.
Yeah, absolutely. The only caveat to the localisation is the equalities point, that actually in order to localise that, it has to be about the wellbeing of all the people in that area. If there is a small area and statistics are limited, it may be difficult to get the views of people who are particularly marginalised in society through statistics. So you may want to add in to that model some deliberative democracy, you know, participatory engagement, so that you're not relying solely on what can be at a local level quite small numbers, which we know exclude some of the groups in society who have the worst wellbeing outcomes. So there isn't an issue there. The more local you get, the harder you have to work at really understanding what's going on. But the principle of subsidiarity, which is what we're really talking about here, is one of the principles that as an organisation at Carnegie UK we have identified as one of the key drivers of wellbeing. As you say, the more local decisions are taken, the more likely those decisions are to be taken in ways that improve wellbeing rather than in a one-size-fits-all across the nation or indeed the
union. And they were pointing out that it's better for the ownership because people within that local community feel that they have devised the policies that are actually working, and that was successful in A, getting people to understand them better, and B, getting them well motivated to deliver them. I thought that was quite a strong point they made.
Yeah, and there are now international examples coming forward of the relationship between local wellbeing frameworks, so the localising of it, and activities like participatory budgeting. We did some of that activity in Northern Ireland over the past few years. I've seen just this morning some work in New South Wales coming in, you know, again, so trying to make that connection between subsidiarity, participatory budgeting, participatory democracy mechanisms, and the outcomes approach.
Okay, and I mean, it actually leads into my second question. Would you accept some of the comments that we got that ring fencing potentially can be a bit of an issue in this? That too much, I think, and these were largely local government people were saying that it was almost too much ring fencing, that they'd actually like to have some autonomy to spend some money on areas of policy where they knew there had been good effects. And that was actually not to do with economic statistics, that was much more to do with social wellbeing. Would you accept that that's...
Yeah. Yes, and again, you know, our history of research at Carnegie UK, we have a significant body of research and evidence about asset-based community development in rural communities, and the importance for, you know, small communities to be able to determine their own priorities and then feel engagement and ownership came through all of that work, and it adds to the sustainability of those initiatives if people do feel that there is local ownership of them, you know, so they go deeper, they last longer as a result. Now, a lot of our work was about, it was about community ownership, so it was about community ownership of land and community ownership of energy, but yet there is a sense at which, at a very hyper-local level, those things can come together and create very local well-being approaches that are specific to the needs of those populations.
Thank you.
Thank you. Michelle, to be followed by Douglas.
Well, good morning. I'm going to touch on a couple of themes that have been peripherally discussed already. I'm interested in the complexity that arises from accountability, government accountability versus subsidiarity. I think possibly, you know, the unwise or uneducated might say it must be this or that, because that means they're not recognising the complexity. If I can give you an example, there are, as we know, there are many areas of critical change that the Scottish Government has no say over, fiscal levers, monetary levers and so on. And it's kind of on the record that the Scottish Government will try to do something about child poverty in terms of child poverty payment that then is kind of clawed back via another route by the UK government. And that's well on the record. My concern about that is not just from a political perspective, it's actually one of an accountability perspective, because the Scottish Government is accountable for all of these outcomes whilst not having the control and the power to deliver on them. So, and that's on the record already. But I'd appreciate some of your thoughts about the complexity of that, how we can start to square it off, and given the examples which I've read, all the contributions you've made, what you've seen of that happen elsewhere in Ireland and in Wales as well, particularly in reference to soft and hard powers, you put it out. So perhaps just fleshing out some of the complexity a bit more, because it strikes me that it's too simple to say it's this or that. Jennifer, maybe you'd like to go first, since you were looking at me and nodding me, which I took was agreement.
I don't think anything in complex public policy is ever this or that. It's always a mixture, mm-hmm. you know. And I think the example given earlier was about childcare hours. Now, actually, yeah. if you interpret childcare as core infrastructure that allows a country to function, you know, then it may not be something that is up for, you know, local negotiation. But that's a conversation that we probably need to have as a country, you know, and where do the differences lie in that right now, coming out of the pandemic, and are they different from where we started, you know, when this parliament was established, which they may well be. Squaring it off, I think there is an issue about local democracy and the local democratic deficit, you know, that actually the connection between local people and their councils is not particularly strong, you know, and that then, you know, we have layers of accountability over and above that, which sometimes appear to be accountable and sometimes are not accountable. And there are, and have been in my, you know, career in policy in Scotland, you know, constant calls for reviews of the relationship between Scottish Government, local government and that community or hyper-local level. I'm not sure that the national performance framework or the national outcomes can resolve all of that. I think what is difficult is that it sits alongside an imperfect system, and it's then, you know, it is either trying to resolve that problem in the soft power way that Dr. French refers to, or people put so much weight on it that they actually think that it is, you know, it is that top-down approach, and it is neither of those things. You know, the Scottish Government itself is not accountable for the National Performance Framework, while it might feel itself to be. It is only accountable in the Act to having regard to it, you know, and that, you know, there is not the clear and linear line that some people think is there. Does that help? Sorry.
It definitely does. A couple of comments from Dr. French and Dr. Elliott would be useful as well. Thank you.
Yeah, I think maybe my thoughts on this are with regards to accountability and how that can sort of be reconciled with the kind of extra-organisational nature of outcomes, which are sort of intrinsic to an outcomes approach. And it's sort of been grappled with in two ways. Either we try and hold people accountable regardless of that, and what happens there is the Northern Ireland experience of here's your indicator and at the expense of all the other outcomes and indicators, that sort of narrow tunnel vision, or it results in the gaming behaviours that you see, for instance, with the work programme, the Troubles Families programme, you know, flagship UK government policies of the Cameron Clegg era, and the history of performance management, just littered with examples of these issues. My view, and I think this is the sort of emerging academic consensus, as you reframe your vision of accountability from attributional accountability, here's the movement, and we assign this attribution to you, the government, for the movement and the national outcomes, to contribution. So you are held to account for your contribution to a broad range of national outcomes or indicators, and that's done in a contextually specific way. And again, I'd refer to Wales in this. Now, what they've done is the way that well-being plans, assessments, and objective setting, a localisation process, is conducted, is based on a community planning partnership, a public body, a local government, thinking about a stretching attributional sort of plan, which sets out not just, for instance, you know, if you were a housing association, they're not held to account in Wales, but not just my repairs and my occupancy rates and such forth, how I can contribute to antisocial behaviour in my area, how I can contribute to sort of child poverty. Are there areas that I can think beyond the boundaries of my organisation creatively and collaboratively to make a broader impact? So that sort of stretching contribution plan that is the start of that process has to be an accountability procedure, and that's conducted through the collaboration between the Future Generations Commissioner and Audit Wales, and then there needs to be a post hoc assessment of that, not just on what's gone according to plan, but, you know, taking account of context in that, you know, the intervening factors, and trying to assess a link, you know, has that creative stretching process been genuine in that context? So really, accountability is situational, and it's based on contribution, not attribution, and not top-down assignment of accountability. But there are examples of this now in practice which show that can be done. The other thing I would add, sorry, is that oversight function that the Commissioner has provided has given them all the information that they need to be, they feel, to make a valid assessment on who's stretched themselves and who hasn't, and to meet out that balance of soft power versus hard power, who needs the coercion, who needs the encouragement and the support, and who needs to be potentially taken to that next level, formal investigation and review.
And before you come in, Dr. Elliott, you specifically have mentioned it about the role of the Auditor General in terms of accountability, because that also is getting more complex, where we have policy decisions being bypassing the Scottish Parliament and going direct to local councils, but without yet a clear line of sight of scrutiny and accountability, just a promise maybe to look at some point later. So I wondered if you had any thoughts about the complexity around that, although I note with interest what you're saying about the attributive kind of accountability. I think that's an interesting theme.
Yeah, I mean, I would just, first of all, I would just agree with what Max had said. I think when you look at this idea of a wellbeing framework, there's a lot of similarities with, for example, the Sustainable Development Goals and how they've been set up, and the philosophy underpinning those is that each nation state demonstrates how it's contributing towards the Sustainable Development Goals. They're not expected to be ticking every single box and you know, kind of being held to account in the way that, you know, a kind of performance framework would make you maybe think, but it's more about how you're making that contribution. And I think, you know, there's a similar philosophy potentially here for a wellbeing framework. And yes, there are complexities around all of this and how different bodies contribute to the different goals or to the different outcomes. And I think that's where really collaboration plays a key part. And, you know, we've seen, you know, a number of Audit Scotland reports have highlighted, you know, the need for more joined up thinking within Scotland, the need for more collaborative leadership. They've highlighted issues with health and social care integration, for example. And so, you know, coming back to something that Liz had said, you know, do we need it? Well, you know, we definitely need this because, you know, although an individual agency or an individual council might say, well, we're doing this anyway, that misses the point. It's not about what an individual organisation is doing, it's what the collective system is doing and how people are working together across that and actually, you know, sharing learning and sharing experience between Scottish Government and local government, between local government and different ALEOs, between, you know, the different parts of the system ultimately. And I think, you know, there's something there around learning as well that needs to be taken into account here about how we encourage more learning and more shared experience across the system and indeed between the Scottish Government and the Welsh Government and the Northern Ireland Executive and the UK Government as well. There's a great opportunity here because this has been developed in slightly different ways across the devolved administrations. There's a real opportunity to learn from a lot of the good practice that's taken place. And I'm not sure that's happening yet. Mm-hmm. You know, it's almost Scotland is a silo in itself. You know, can we learn more from what other administrations are doing? I think, you know, the answer is, an absolute yes.
Yeah. My last question, actually, is, which again we've kind of been dancing around, references a concept of agency. We've alluded to, you know, when you've got kind of potentially top-down and bodies quite naturally taking ownership in various different ways. But if we think about it from a bottom-up perspective, going back to what you were saying, Jennifer, about subsidiarity, but rather than thinking just at sort of the very bottom of the triangle, the person in the street, how would you go about if we were reflecting the National Performance Framework to ensure the agency is instilled in every single touch point of the framework, just thinking it from a completely different perspective, because we haven't used the word in the session today, but it's kind of jumping out at me. I can see you're all thinking about that, which is probably who wants to go first, Max?
Well, I go first, and then you go first.
Yeah. So I think there are really interesting developments in Scotland around, for example, the Leaders Forum, creating space to reflect and to learn together. And we are getting better at that and you know, hopefully at sharing experiences. I think there are ways of encouraging that by asking the right questions. And maybe this is one of the things where we have, you know, we have a role for an agency of some kind to help say, well, you know, actually, how would you go further with that? How would you improve your contribution there? How would you develop that further? Not in a scrutiny way, but in a learning together methodology. So a much less hierarchical, you know, and much flatter approach to say that we accept, as we were discussing earlier, that we all, you know, adhere to the principles of wanting to improve lives in Scotland, and we all believe that the outcomes-based approach is a way of doing that, then, you know, setting ourselves a set of reflective, complex questions, say, well, you know, are we doing enough on this? And I just come back to one final point, because we haven't really talked that much about the environment or net zero or climate change and all of this, but the solution to our contribution as a nation to the climate crisis is not going to be in SEPA, you know, or in the environment. It is going to be all of us doing our piece, and that will be a case in point of exactly that. How do you go from, you know, the personal responsibility through to community responsibility, agency, all the way through the system to allow us to feel that we are making our contribution, but also to have that contribution respected by society? So it goes in both directions. Mm-hmm.
Last week comments, anything to add?
Well, I think it's a really interesting question and a really worthwhile way of looking at this, because the outcomes that the National Performance Framework sets forth cannot be achieved through top-down imposition. It can't be achieved without agency. And the success, to a large extent, will be on whether it inspires that at various levels. So that's why a branding and marketing approach to kind of awareness raising is so important. You know, a similar question can be asked to the Scottish Government. Why has it been seen as important to adopt the UN Sustainable Development Goals and to seek to align that? There was nothing forcing Scotland to do that, but it took it upon itself and it used its agency because it saw it as an important thing to do. I think that is an important element to sort of carry forth with the you know, the resultant implementation kind of strategy, the ongoing approach to implementation, keeping that as an active approach. So, you know, that would involve taking stock of the public mood and really focusing on, you know, are people responding to this as an opportunity rather than a threat? So I would just add that as a general point.
Yeah, and I guess from my perspective, agency links back to leadership. You need leadership in order to take on that agency and to do things. And just picking up on some of the things that Jen had said about learning together, you know, that's another kind of key aspect of my research is around learning and particularly around public administration. And I do think there is a bit of a gap there that needs addressed in terms of the wider, you know, development of leadership within Scotland and specifically in relation to public administration. I know, for example, the UK government are developing a national leadership centre for civil servants. To what extent are the Scottish Government involved with that, and to what extent is that going to be used as a tool to help develop more learning across the devolved administrations and with the UK government? Obviously, myself and Max come from Northumbria University, but there are, you know, many more local universities that arguably have a role to play in this as well. But, you know, arguably, again, there's a lack of capacity there. We only have, as I mentioned in my written submission, we only have one MPA programme in Scotland and one MPP. You know, so where do we get that investment in leadership in order to make that, you know, make it happen? Where do we get the learning opportunities and how do you embed that not just within the civil service but right across the public sector actually? That is another aspect of this that I think needs some consideration.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Douglas?
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and I'll be brief because I noticed this time has got away from us. It was just around the whole scrutiny and accountability again, and I would imagine that one of the key recommendations coming from this committee will be whether we have a commissioner, the role on Audit Scotland. And it's really just to get an idea in my head, you know, what would they actually do most of the time? You know, how many people are we talking about? How big a unit would it be?
Mm. Oh, what, Wales is about 15 people, I think. Okay. So it is. Is it gone up? Yeah. Okay, Max has more recent information. He's saying 30. It is a reasonable-sized office, and it has a research function. So it carries out primary research on how the Act is being implemented. It scrutinises plans, so the wellbeing assessments, local wellbeing assessments and so on, scrutinises those to assess the level at which they are meeting the ambitions within the Act. They have a media role, which is one of the things that I mentioned briefly in my submission, was actually that Scotland has not done well at explaining to the media that this is a new way of doing business, but the Commissioner's Office in Wales has quite a prominent media role to talk about the wellbeing of future generations and trying to encourage that way of thinking about social progress in the round through their sort of public engagement and outreach activities. So you would see that as the cluster of things. They very rarely use, you know, the hard powers. You know, a lot of it is in soft power. But the ability to use the hard power to call in information and to make public statements about the information that they receive is powerful. You know, so even if they use it very rarely, you know, it does have an effect. The most obvious one being the motorway that was the decision on whether or not to build a motorway around Cardiff was changed on the basis of the assessment from the office. Well, it was the First Minister who changed the decision ultimately, but it was on the basis of evidence from the research team within the Future Generations Commissioner, who worked out how many years it would take for future generations to pay off the debt for that road. Mm-hmm. And putting that evidence into the debate changed the nature of the conversation about whether or not the cost-benefit analysis was worthwhile. So that's the type of activity that they do. Now, Scotland has, you know, a number of commissioner offices already. We've got Audit Scotland. There are a number of models that you could look to develop from Scotland rather than starting out, you know, completely from scratch.
It's just obviously we spoke about decluttering earlier.
Yeah.
I was just concerned that this would be, you know, adding more clutter to the landscape.
Well, I think another function that the Commissioner provides is it provides the know-how and the a lot of things that we talked about, the accessibility to the framework. So it provides support, guidance, workshops, close personal working. It supports the Welsh Senate in using the Act. And it provides training programmes, and it provides this sort of outreach function at a much larger scale than we've got in Scotland. And really sort of, you could imagine in Scotland, one of the things that we've got, we've done well, is that we've got a lot of people knocking at the door of the National Performance Framework, wanting to use it, third sector organisations that are interested in it, but they don't know how. Providing that guidance and that support and those shortcuts to, from a position of expertise and how that's embedded, would have enabled those organisations to adopt and implement the National Performance Framework much better than they currently have. It's normally this, after the fact sort of signposting thing that goes on that we've talked about. So sort of scaffolding that process and providing a lot of the infrastructure there. The other thing to talk about, I suppose, is that they've been operating at their capacity for a number of years, and they've noted that to their Parliament and to the Welsh Government that the scale of support demands that come into their office really outweighs the resourcing that they're provided with. I mean, they get over £1.5 million pounds per year is the roundabout budget figure. I think it's maybe slightly more than that. And still, the scale of demand coming into them is really pushing them beyond capacity. More than half of that demand comes from government. So government requests for support from civil servants, and the other half comes from not just public bodies, but also organisations that are not accountable within the Act. So they have that wider movement building approach. And really that shows you sort of the scale of resourcing, I think, that would be needed to really move the NPF from a government performance framework to a societal wellbeing framework. Mm-hmm.
More pieces of information, if that's all right. Thank you. The first one is just to remind committee of the previous evidence that, to the best of our understanding, there are about 5 people currently involved in the delivery team within Scottish Government. So that is 6 times more people involved mm-hmm. in the Welsh office. It is a significantly increased capacity. And the other piece of historic information is, of course, the Sustainable Development Commissions were closed now well over a decade ago as a result of UK Government decision. The Welsh Office of the Future Generations Commissioner was established as a direct response to the closure of the Sustainable Development Commissioner, and indeed a lot of those commissioners were involved in the establishment of that office. So there was a clear line between the Sustainable Development Commission closing and the setting up of the Office for the Wellbeing of Future Generations. Mm-hmm. Now, there has been a longer time period in Scotland, but I think you can still say that actually, of the organisational history that a new office would be coming from, it would be related to the work that mm-hmm. the Sustainable Development Commission used to do prior to their abolition.
Okay, and the Commissioner in Wales, they don't carry out an audit function. That's still carried out by Audit Wales. I'm just trying to think what role Audit Scotland would play in all of this.
Yeah, well, you have the sort of before and after the fact, the sort of passover process in Wales, with the Commissioner taking charge at the start and then Audit Wales coming in after the fact to review process and review progress. They've both got long-term sort of scrutiny roles on the sort of broader picture in Wales, but there's this sort of passover approach okay. that's used there.
And one last piece, if I may. You mentioned that road in Wales. Who would have carried out that function if there wasn't a wellbeing commissioner?
Nobody.
Okay.
In the absence of a Sustainable Development Commission, while there were a number of academics and NGOs campaigning to draw attention to the fact that this was not something that they considered to be in the best interest of Wales, there was nobody of the status within the system who was able to get into the decision-making process to call that to account until there was an Office of Future Wellbeing and that relationship was led. As I say, it was the First Minister's decision, but he did it based on evidence provided by the office.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Douglas, and I'd like to thank our witnesses. We are now at the end of our evidence session, but your detailed evidence was greatly appreciated by our committee, and we'll continue with our evidence taking on the National Performance Framework next week. We'll now take a break until 12 minutes past 11. Our next item of business will be an evidence section with the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence on the Scottish Parliament's website as part of a scrutiny of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body's budget. We are joined today by Jackson Carlott, MSP, member of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body, and Mr Carlott is accompanied by Scottish Parliament officials, Michelle Hegarty, Deputy Chief Executive, Alan Balhari, Group Head of Digital Services, and Susan Duffy, Group Head of Engagement and Communications. Good morning, and I welcome you all to the meeting and invite Mr Carlott to make some opening remarks. Jackson.
I know there's been quite a detailed correspondence between us, so I don't think there's any particular need to repeat all of that, and we're quite happy to move into questions, but I suppose I would just start by saying I'm not a website designer, I'm not an IT specialist, I'm probably one of those dinosaurs who is the last person you would consult in any of these matters at all. I imagine, probably like many other lay people, you can go to PC World and buy a website for sort of £5.99 and that will probably suffice. But of course, in an organisation as complex, as huge and as of such public interest, accessed by so many people from not just within the Parliament but from without and from around the world, it's important that we have a website which, after 10 years, bear in mind the previous website was launched basically when the iPad was launched, and so much has changed in life since then, not least mobile communications and the ability of people to try and access all these things in quite different ways to the ways that they were accessed historically, which I'm afraid the previous site, which was largely obsolete, incapable of being maintained, and certainly was not something which was able to be accessed easily, required to be upgraded. This was very much a feature of the Commission on Parliamentary Reform that Ken McIntosh established, on which I was pleased to sit, in terms of the public engagement meetings that we conducted, the inability of the public to access the website, something that perhaps familiar users here in the building felt they could do with ease, but for those people trying to engage from elsewhere, it isn't, it wasn't. And so that was the justification and reasoning when the corporate body took the decision some years ago to commence the establishment of a new website. So that's how it came about. And I know you will have detailed questions on what came about and possibly the process that led to that as well. And we're very happy to take them, as of course Michelle, Alan and Susan will variously assist me or in fact prevent me from from contributing as we go through.
OK, well, thank you very much for that opening statement, which was very helpful. I have to say that there is great interest from members of the committee in this particular issue, and therefore I will try and restrict myself to not asking myriad questions on the issue, but I will obviously kick off with a few. We do obviously have a focus on a couple of areas. One obviously is the scrutiny function that this committee undertakes and how the website relates to that, but also the cost itself is of course a major issue for us. And I don't pretend either to be an expert on websites, but a simple Googling on websites, as you said, you can get websites for only a few hundred pounds. We do realise this is complex, but then again, major organisations understand the kind of cost for introducing websites is considerably less than what the Scottish Parliament appears to have paid by a number of zeros, and also the timescale to develop it is obviously a matter of concern. And we were obviously sent a list of the cost of other websites, for example, from various UK departments, and these vary from £14,000 up to millions of pounds, but we don't know whether we're comparing apples with apples or oranges with oranges, because there's no great detail in there. But the first question I would kick off with is that the Parliament's project began in 2017, with cost and delivery spanning subsequent years until 2021. But in each year, no specific costs are provided against the web project, and I'm keen to ask and find out why that is. The web project budget was put forward by the Digital Strategy Board. This is a response from the presiding officer. As part of the overall project portfolio bid, which comprises part of the SPCB's annual budget bid from 2017-18, SPCB approves the Parliament annual budget bid and its indicative bid for the financial year, as we know. But then we were also advised that officials have recognised the need to provide increased detail on major multi-year project costs as part of the annual budgeting process to the SPCB and the Finance and Public Administration Committee. So obviously the obvious question there, as part of this question, is, you know, why were we not previously, and since when did that realisation dawn that we should actually get this detailed information? And when were SPCB members themselves aware of the ongoing costs of this project? Because I've heard a number of views that they weren't necessarily au fait with these costs.
I think Michelle will come in, but can I just say that the corporate body was made aware of the overall project at the point that it was launched back in 2017 and the years over which it would run. The budget for the website was not separately identified in each year. It is accommodated within the overall IT and digital budget. So there was never any exceptional item. It's one of those things, along with other parts of the maintenance of the building, that have to be planned for on a kind of annualised basis over a period of time. And so the corporate body was kind of aware of it in the sense that we understood the case for the new website. We were given an indicative idea of what the website development would likely be and the timescale. But given that lead times for different bits of it can be compromised in any one year, it wasn't necessarily the case that any one part of it was scheduled within the budget and identified separately as the bit of the website development that would happen in that particular calendar year. And you're right. I mean, I think it's a reasonable thing for a parliament to point to the other government services websites, because we're not just a commercial business, we are a parliament, and with an obligation to both the internal users and also to the external users to ensure that we have a website which is fit for purpose and has capacity to serve the parliament, not just for a year, but, you know, for the decade ahead. Michelle?
Yeah, convener, excuse me if I don't cover all your questions, please just repeat. In terms of building on what Jackson said about the corporate body's involvement, which is obviously at a strategic level on the advice of its officials, approving the budget bit, which comes obviously to scrutiny in front of the Finance Committee each financial year. And behind the scenes then, the Clerk Chief Executive has obviously got a delegation set out under the Scotland Act for the day-to-day functions of running the Parliament. In turn, there's delegations to the group heads like Alan and Susan for responsibility of their areas of the business, which includes all projects, programmes getting undertaken. So at the time when this project began, the budget bid was obviously created and developed during 2016, put forward to the Finance Committee in the evidence session of the December of that year. And it went through a process where the Digital Strategy Board, which has an actual strategy for the organisation and how it wants to take forward digital investment, prioritises the range of projects that it feels needs to be undertaken to address that strategy. That then is put forward to the Strategic Resources Board, which is myself and the Clerk Chief Executive with the input of our Chief Financial Officer. We look at the prioritisation of the entire Parliament budget, but within that we look at prioritisation within the project budget, which is usually about £4.5 million, as a part of the overall Parliament budget, which is £112 million, excluding capital costs for this year. So in terms of that scrutiny, then we determine the prioritisation between the different portfolios, because digital is only one of the areas that we have projects spent in that can range across a number of other areas. The other one that's most significant is facilities management, which is a lot of the infrastructure and services to do with running the building. So we make priority decisions across all of that, and we look at the detail of how the prioritisation has been undertaken by the different business areas. Then that goes forward to our leadership group, where we, again, scrutinise the budget bid before we advise it to corporate body. The corporate body has a few different cuts, usually, at looking at the budget before it is signed off, and then it's put forward to scrutiny by the finance, in front of the Finance Committee. So that's the process that would have been undertaken under the various delegations that come from the Clerk Chief Exec down to the group heads and through the governance that we have as officials before the corporate body is advised by officials.
OK, but from here on in, you're looking to give us the breakdowns that have not been provided previously? previously. Would that be right?
So in the budget at the moment, when we bring our budget bid forward to you again in December, we set out the all of the various components of the Parliament's budget across members' expenses, office holders, etc. And then we also have a Schedule 3, which gives more of the detail on what we expect to deliver under projects. But what we do in there is give a high-level overview of the kind of key elements of the project budget, but not every project, because obviously there are numerous projects undertaken in the organisation. So we pull out the most significant areas of spend. The thing I think that we have been doing over the last 4 years, which we're keen to now look at how we can build in for both the corporate body and for the Finance Committee, is that where we see there's going to be potentially multi-year spend on a project or a programme of work, because we've started to develop a project pipeline which is looking over 5 to 6 years to try and even out spend on project spend. So when we see that, I think what we're going to try and do for both the corporate body and for the Finance Committee is not just say that, you know, we can meet this within our indicative budgets in the annual cycle, but to say up front, this is likely to be a 2 or 3 year spend, a high level estimate is X, Y or Z. So we will seek to do that going forward.
Can I just say as well, Convener, the one other point, the corporate body obviously does review these things, but in the sense that they are approved projects within a schedule, then it's a monitoring and an understanding of how the work is progressing. Where the corporate body might be more exercised is where a project comes before it that comes out of left field, if you like, for which there has been no provision whatsoever. For example, the recommendations for Police Scotland in relation to security in the building, none of which had been anticipated in a 5 or a 10 year plan, and which required to be progressed with a degree of urgency. That would be a project where the total costs and the recommendations even of Police Scotland would be considered by the corporate body and may or may not be accepted as we decided what we were going to authorise, and then the exceptional item of expense that we would have to approve.
OK, let's move on to the tender. We were advised that specialist technical staff were procured through existing framework contracts, and the technology behind the site was also procured through an existing contract in place at the time. But why not go out to tender?
Can I invite Alan to answer that on behalf of the group?
Certainly. So we had current contracts in place which we wanted to use. They obviously let us move forward at a faster pace to get things going.
Excuse me, at a faster pace? It took like 3-4 years to develop this website?
It would have taken an extra year if we'd added on a procurement exercise on top of that as well, when we didn't really need to. You know, the contracts were already in place and we could actually utilise those. So before we'd even start, just to get through a procurement phase for a high-value project, would typically take between 9 months to 12 months, following our standard procurement policies and procedures that we have in place in the Parliament. So the frameworks that are in place, those were let through the government frameworks that are in place, so mini competitions in those, or there is a framework there which actually includes multiple suppliers. So each time, for instance, we were going out for using the interim services contract, we were approaching, I think there's 7 companies on that, and looking for them all to submit responses to give us the best value for money from that contract when we're looking for a contractor on that position.
So you're saying that in the real world outside this building, that normal procurement and for a website, because when I look at my website, say I can produce one in a week or a month or something like that, I don't really see any that say, well, this will take like 3 or 4 years. I mean, there seems to be a lack of reality compared to the rest of the world out here. And Jackson talked about, you know, a website that makes it easier for users that are less familiar with parliamentary process, such as the public, to find and understand. Now, I have to say that as an MSP, I find that the current website actually more difficult to actually manage than the one we had before. I mean, the very fact you have to go onto the old website to look at the official report, to me, is a complete nonsense. What do people in this Parliament actually want a website and the members of the public for? To look at the official report, committee reports, questions, you know, motions, parliamentary bills, you know, to tell us that this is incredibly, you know, complicated and sophisticated technological solution to some indecipherably complex problem, when people just want to know who submitted a motion on what, or who's asked a question on this, or what bill's coming up. I mean,
I mean, are we really expected to believe that we got value for money in a £3 million project which took years to come in and, frankly, is like a horse, is like a camel, you know, horse designed by a committee? To me, it's a mess, and I know other colleagues feel the same way. I mean, is this really the best that we can do for the huge amount of investment that's went in?
Well, that's a suitably pejoratively phrased question, convener. And I suppose, as someone who doesn't access websites and things, I might find these things complicated as well. It certainly is the case that if you were an internal building user, you understood how the previous website worked and you were familiar with your way around it. It was a hugely lugubrious website. It had hundreds of thousands of documents within it, which were slowing down its ability to operate efficiently. And that's very unlike, for example, the website that you would expect to come across for any government department elsewhere or any other parliament. We were very, very dense in terms of content. And if you were not one of the internal building users familiar with the site, you would really not actually have had a very good experience. Have we got the final product and is it not capable of evolving further? I'm sure that's not the case. Now, I know Susan's very much involved in engagement in relation to how the ongoing development of the website will progress, and it might be worth Susan saying a few words at this point.
Yeah, I mean, just to say that the model that the website was developed on was one whereby we wanted to develop our in-house capability so that it wasn't a case that we would just build a new website and that was it. It was then incapable of being improved, which were lessons that we had learned from the previous website back in 2010. So the idea is that, yes, the website was handed over to us in-house in a state where we could take it forward. But what we've done through the course of this project is to develop our in-house expertise, both within teams within my group and in Alan's team as well, so that we can constantly develop and improve the website because, you know, no website is ever finished. We very much appreciate that there are certainly mixed views in terms of the website. Just one thing I did want to say, just following up on Jackson's point about people from outside not being able to find their way around the website as much as they perhaps could do, and from an engagement perspective. Just as an example, under the old website, if you wanted to engage with a consultation that a committee was running, really you needed to know which committee was looking at which issue because you needed to go into the website through that particular committee. Whereas under the new website, you go in, there's a list of consultations and it's done by a list of issues that are being looked at rather than by committees. Now, I know that that's different to the way in which it was done before. I used to head up the committee office, so I had a really good idea of which committee was doing which piece of scrutiny. I don't have as much of a knowledge of that now, and I do find that particularly helpful.
I would suggest that's a relatively minor point, given the other search functions, etc., which people would probably use more frequently. But I only want to touch on one other area because all my colleagues are keen to come in. Now, one of the things we looked at was areas of spend, which I found quite interesting. So, for example, in 1920. The salaries for people actually working on this project were £928,000 that year. The actual money spent on software was £4,000. The following year, the salaries were £940,000 with only £2,000 on software. I mean, what kind of salaries are people getting paid that are actually working on this? How many people were actually working on this?
Alan?
So, the costs really attributed, those salaries you're talking about there are day rates. So we employ contractors with specialist skills on day rates. And they vary throughout the project, where they vary between £300 per day up to £840 per day, depending on the skill set and the market value at that time.
So even £840 a day or £300, whatever, it still took years to actually produce this website. And I notice also in terms of the responsible presiding officer, it said that apart from the challenge of managing, coordinating a large team virtually, members of the team dealing with issues also had childcare and homeschooling. So basically we're spending all this money and we've also got to accept that folk, you know, who are earning these huge day rates have got to juggle their homeschooling, etc., and childcare. I mean, is that not taken into consideration when these things are
Convener, I might come in and clarify on that point. Alan is referring to the specialist day rate card, which was obviously part of a contract which had been let at scale in the public sector. And the reason we go into these framework contracts is because they offer better value for the public sector. In terms of the various things that impacted, the website was delivered largely to the timeframe set out. I think what you're referring to about homeschooling, etc., was because we hadn't envisaged, obviously, the pandemic hitting towards the end of the project, and there was naturally a number of challenges in delivering the project. And we just have set out for your benefit the fact that we had to introduce two new services to Parliament. One was the remote voting, the other was the hybrid parliamentary business platform, which were not projects that were envisaged, but we had to address those in order to keep Parliament running. And so some of the specialist staff, as I understand it, were deployed onto those contracts. We also had staff having, as your own staff would have had to do, go home and then deal with the fact that the schools were shut, etc., for a period of the pandemic. There was illness, people had COVID. So we were balancing, as you would have been with your own staff, a range of factors which naturally impacted on capacity levels in the Parliament, coupled with the fact that we had, in the last 2 years of the session, a demonstrable uptick in parliamentary business, which meant that also for staff who were not specialist staff in terms of delivering the website, but who were going to have to be trained up to support the website whenever it went into business as usual, clearly there was capacity challenges there because of the support required for parliamentary business. But all of these things were just challenges that we would expect, maybe not the COVID one, we wouldn't have expected that, but these are challenges that we have to try and navigate as part of delivering Parliament, running business and running projects as part of business.
Okay, so with people earning up to, well, more than £200,000 a year, it seems, on a day rate basis for this, how many people are actually working on it? I mean, if you actually look at 850 a day, it comes up with 1,100 person days. If it's 300, it's 3,000 person days. So I imagine it's obviously somewhere between that. So how many folk were actually working on this project on an ongoing basis? And these specialists were needed?
Don't really have that figure to hand, Convener, I'm sorry. I mean, I think it was roughly about 10 to 12 contractors we're employing at a moment in time, and we're also engaging, you know, our own staff as well. I think the difference in salaries you've indicated from the table there, it's worth pointing out the backfill is actually recruiting to parliamentary staff, so they were under our terms and conditions. So the contractors that we brought in, the high day rate contractors, when they were off for childcare issues or whatever they were off for, they weren't actually receiving any payment for those days that they did not attend or could not attend. So, you know, so if they're off ill, they're on holiday, or, you know, through childcare demands through the pandemic, they were not actually paid during that time by us.
Okay, thanks for that. I'm going to open out the session to colleagues around the table. So the first person to ask will be questions will be Daniel, to be followed by Michelle.
So there are two, I think, primary issues with this. Both, I think, one in terms of the transparency around the decision-making up front, but secondly, I think, around the level of information provided about the project on an ongoing basis. So, Mr. Carla, neither you or I are website designers. That's a fair comment, but we are both business people. And in business, it's a good idea, and indeed, if you're a large business, a requirement that if you have undertakings which have multi-year obligations, that you specify those adequately in your profit and loss account. Now, if I look at the 2017-18 budget submission from the SPCB, the only indication that the Parliament was undertaking a £3 million website contract is a little line in Schedule 3, which is the description against IT digital services projects, and it reads as follows: information technology digital change projects include rolling out the MSP case management system to more MSPs and their staff, delivering a new Parliament website and internet, fair enough, software, Windows 10 and Office 365, and hardware upgrades for SPS staff, replacing the Parliament telephone system. So what was in there that would have alerted our predecessor committee that the Parliament was undertaking a significant website? Because that's pretty hidden, isn't it?
Well, in the year you refer to, I gave evidence to the committee and your colleagues asked me questions on the subject of the development of the new website, which are included in the official report. So MSPs were aware on the committee of the development of the website and interrogated me on the development of it.
But there was no indication there, really, was there, that there was a three-year, £3 million undertaking that was being carried out? I mean, do you think this was sufficiently transparent in terms of the significance and scale of the website project?
In terms of the development and delivery of multi-year projects of core services that are provided by the Parliament, there will be a number of different examples that you could point to. I mean, the maintenance of the lifts probably being one that, you know, you might take a look at and ask, how much do I know about how much it's costing to replace the lifts in the building or to maintain them? These are all incorporated within the particular line item elements of the budget. I think the corporate body would be more concerned were we to find that there was a significant, and we would be alerted to, if there was a significant problem evolving in the development of a project which was now spiralling out of control or cost in some way. In each year, and at each meeting of the corporate body throughout the year, the different departments of the Parliament schedule fairly detailed and extensive reports, which we consider. Many of these, I think, are subsequently available as minutes to the public. And so, yes, I do. I mean, I think in terms of the overall portfolio within a 100 million budget, I don't know what it was at the time, maybe 80 million budget at that time, I do think that the level of detail that the committee were seeking to have or to ask us about was accommodated. And as I say, I was asked questions in that year and in subsequent years about its ongoing development.
Yeah, well, look, I appreciate that acknowledgement. I would suggest that £3 million in a £100 million budget as a percentage would warrant further detail.
No, but that's £3 million in 1 year, whereas the £100 million is annual.
Indeed, but just as an expression in terms of, compared to the overall budget, it's a significant project. And indeed, to understand whether it's going out of control, certainly you need that level of detail. But the problem with transparency goes a little further. If I look at the detail that's been provided by the SPCB about where the costs have gone, all we have been provided with is a schedule of resource costs set out by technical and non-technical contractors, but there's no specificity about what work they were doing. I would expect in any IT project to see phases split out so that you understand where those efforts are being applied, whether that's the initial analysis, design, build, testing, and user acceptance phases, for example. Those are very, very basic things, and yet we have none of that level of detail. Can you explain why that's not been provided?
I can come in. So what we provide to the corporate or to the finance committee is obviously an overview of the entire Parliament budget, of which is 112 million this year. And then within that, we separate out, obviously, members' expenses, office holders. So we provide you with an overview of the Parliament budget within the bit which is the project spend. Then we group and give you some idea of the kind of key elements of spend within that, but not the detail of the actual schedule of how it's going to be delivered or the methodology, which is something that officials are charged and delegated with doing in terms of running the Parliament from the corporate body.
So what I don't understand here is that you've described in Table 2, in terms of your submission to the committee, these as being areas of spend, yeah. But that's not what they are. It's a time profile broken down by resource type. And if we were, you know, in order to get a good handle on any IT project, you need to understand that effort by phase. Do you not?
So we don't give you the detail. Well, that detail is available to Alan and to the Digital Strategy Board, and then there's reporting against the milestones in that, which comes into the leadership group on a quarterly basis, and then that is reflected up to the corporate body as well. So there's reporting against the milestones, the key strategic milestones of the actual delivery plan for the project. So that goes on with the officials. It's reported to the corporate body. The Digital Strategy Board takes regular reporting on the project as it was being developed. And beneath the Digital Strategy Board, there was a project board and a project team who were doing regular reporting as well. So it's officials' jobs to get on and run the project, what we're providing to the Finance Committee every year is key areas of spend we expect to see within those grouped programmes. Usually IT, as I say, can also be facilities management. In other years it will be broadcasting, in other years it will be security, depending on what projects we as officials have advised the corporate body need to be undertaken to run Parliament, address risk, replace ageing infrastructure.
So one of my key concerns, looking at the detail that have been presented, and indeed some of the answers that we've had today, is just the level of granularity that this project has been monitored and managed at. Now, Mr. Carlaw said it's not possible to specify which bit of spend would occur in which year, but I would suggest that that's precisely what you should be able to do in any well-run IT project. Any well-run IT project should, as I said before, understand what levels of effort were required by phase, have a project management office that would track those things using things like Gantt charts and projecting spend. But that's not what we seem... I would be grateful if that detail could be provided. And in particular, I'm very concerned by this category of non-technical contractors. That's almost a third of the cost in total. That's a very non-specific category of work. And indeed, can you just explain why you were using third-party contractors to deliver this? I mean, this seems to be a very complicated way of managing a project like this, managing individual contractors on an individual basis, because that seems to be what has happened here.
Can I just come in before I move on to Alan on the governance point? The things you refer to, Gantt charts, where, yeah, maybe a project is following the sort of typical waterfall approach, but there are other methodologies, including Agile, which is now a commonplace methodology in the digital world, and Alan may pick up on that. But yes, estimated costs, phases, milestones, etc., all of these things were in place as part of project governance. That is part of the delegation to the group heads from the Clerk Chief Executive, that they need to manage their budget, they have to have proper administration of their budget, and that they provide assurance to him that they're doing that. In addition, there's performance reporting at various strands of project team, project board, digital strategy board, all the way up to leadership group and advice to the and quarterly performance to the corporate body as well. So just to assure you that we follow standard governance whenever it comes to projects and programmes, but that granularity sits with officials. If I could hand over to Alan on the contractor spend.
Yeah, sure. I'll just come in there. I think, as I stated earlier on, I mean, our strategic intent in this project was to make sure we built the capability in-house. The reason we went out through the contractor route, really, and getting in specialist expertise, including the non-technical side, which includes things like product owner, user research. So, you know, they're not true technical skills like developers and technical architects as such, but, you know, they are part of that project environment, really, for producing a website sitting in there. So we were learning from them as we went, and, you know, when we eventually switched over, that we had enough knowledge then to run the project ourselves sitting in there. And coming in on the point, really, around the governance, I mean, the elements you're talking about were all available at the project level. I mean, there were sprints, actually, it was used rather than, you know, the classic waterfall approach I think Michelle mentioned. So when we were using those sprints, there was 4 weekly sprints with clear plans in there about what was going to be delivered. There was a backlog created about what was not being in there. There was risk management and all of that sitting in there. You know, these were elevated up to the project board where required from the project team, and from the project board they were elevated to DSB or up to to our digital strategy board or to our leadership group, and they were reported on quarterly to the corporate body through our quarterly reporting mechanism sitting in there as well, but at a very high level by the time it got up to that level around the individual elements of what was being delivered day to day.
Can you just finally clarify, I mean, I'm still not clear on the basis of that answer, why you took the decision to manage to deliver this using third-party contractors rather than a single contract, because surely that's inherently more complicated to manage. Because you were saying, acknowledging yourself, there wasn't that expertise in-house to build it. I mean, was there the expertise in-house to manage the variety and number of contractors that you've clearly been employing?
Yep, so we put in place our own project manager. We did have project management capability at that time, and our own SRO, so the senior responsible owner for the project as well. with experience in digital projects. So we put those in place to govern the project. Where we needed to bring in skills, which we didn't have around the development, we did so through the contractor route and passed those knowledge on. That was one of the key part of the whole project, was really to make sure we were developing our internal people so that at the end of this, we have the capability to continue to develop this. And that capability has been used elsewhere, actually, within the organisation. There was a couple of other websites built by our own in-house team, really, around business and parliament, around the festival politics. And also the same skill set that we developed through that allowed us to actually develop the voting application in a very short period of time using the same tools and techniques that we used throughout this project. So we've passed on a lot of knowledge within the...
OK. Well, look, I could ask further questions. I don't want to use up time, but I'd be grateful if somebody could write back to clarify. A number of different boards and management groups have been mentioned. I think some documentation about how they interrelate and how the governance works. And secondly, if the agile methodology was used, I would be grateful if some explanation as to why, because it strikes me that this is a project with a very clear functional footprint, and I'd wonder whether agile is really appropriate for it to deliver a website project like this at all.
Can I make one general observation and perhaps a constructive point? I think, as Michelle was identifying, in terms of the high-level information that the Finance Committee receives, we're looking here at one particular project, and I think there have been questions as to why there was not more information in relation to that project. If we were to drill down all of the projects that the corporate body is overseeing and progressing, and to provide the Finance Committee with that level of detail on them all, then I actually don't think that would be helpful or productive in terms of the progress of the budget or the Finance Committee's understanding of where they wanted to focus their attention. If, on the other hand, there is a particular area within the development of the Parliament and the responsibility of the corporate body that ahead of the budget presentation you would like to have that more detailed information that you're perhaps seeking to have today in relation to the website, then that's something that the corporate body, through its presentation in advance to the Finance Committee, could supply.
Thank you. We'll certainly discuss that in private sessions subsequently. Michelle, to be followed by Douglas.
Thank you and good morning, everybody. Just following on from a couple of points made earlier, given that, Jackson, first of all, a question for you. I appreciate that the corporate body sits at an accountability level, and there's a multitude of projects going on, as Michelle set out. But given what we know now, in terms of, it's fair to say that the cost for the development of the new parliamentary site has caused, at least raised some eyebrows and caused some interest, what recommendations will you be looking to put in place as to how the corporate body can fulfil its accountability considerations more carefully going forward? I'm sure you've reflected on that.
Yeah, I mean, I joined the corporate body just after the discussions had taken place on the website, but I found that I was handed the portfolio and had to go straight to the Finance Committee and then sell it, which was interesting. This was just, those of you of longer memory will remember, after the death of Alex Johnston's, which is what caused my accession to the corporate body at that time. I mean, there are obviously a whole series of projects that I've been involved with in the years I've been on the corporate body, 3 years then and then again since the election last year, where, you know, to someone like me, who has even been in business, I look and I think, crikey, this is a pretty eye-watering way of achieving things. I mean, I'm reminded at times that we are a parliament. And yes, I mean, I suppose my mother would take the view that she wouldn't change the light bulb in her kitchen until it popped because she was going to get value for money for it. But if we took that view about the infrastructure of the building and just waited it for it to fail, for the website to fail, for the lifts to fail, for everything else to fail, the telephone system might be the next one, then I don't think people would thank us for it. So there clearly has to be a long-term projected look at wear and tear, obsolescence, and the need to upgrade and monitor the things that we need to plan for over a number of years. In this case, I know nothing about websites. And given the alacrity with which my SPCB colleagues agreed that I would
represent them this morning, I take the view that there wasn't a great depth of expertise amongst them in any of this either. So naturally, therefore, within the corporate body, in terms of our ongoing monitoring of it, we've an idea of what the original estimate was going to be, what the timescale was going to be. And yes, we do receive, in relation to all the projects that are expensive, some of which we can relate to more easily than others, detailed information. Will we reflect as to whether there are lessons to be learned just from the way this has emerged and the kind of concern perhaps that's being expressed about it? I hope so. And we have already, I think, suggested that we will look to have a further discussion in the corporate body about whether there are any other protocols or natural points in the year where we should be having a further look at these things, just to ensure that we are offering the level of scrutiny that we are able within the portfolio of responsibility that we have.
I think you've now got on to the bit that I was specifically asking about, that were it me, where in effect your neck is on the block, and we've heard a lot of talk about, well, I've never run an IT project, various people have said, that to me indicates that that is a much higher risk in terms of scrutiny and the need for governance at the SPCB level. And if you equate it, it's almost like a kind of, you're a board, you're operating at board level. Any typical board would say, well, these are the projects that carry more risk, and therefore we need greater scrutiny or capacity for scrutiny. So I suppose you reflecting that you'll certainly look at it more carefully. I now feel a wee bit alarmed that for various reasons, that the SPCB isn't able to fulfil its scrutiny role of the workings of the Parliament. Because to me, I'm not surprised about this. Guess what? IT projects are always complex. They always go over budget. They always take longer. I know this because I've run IT projects. Mm. So I suppose picking up on what Daniel said, I personally would like to see out of this a report produced on behalf of the SPCB that they've signed off that said, from a governance perspective, what specifically will change in the light of this project and what we've learned from it.
I mean, I'll ask Michelle to come in, but I mean, that to some extent does exist. We have an amber traffic light warning report on all the risks and developments within the Parliament and the progress that's being made against them. It's not that these things only come about if we ask for them. So we are proactively alerted to that. This website project came largely within budget and on time, subject to the caveat that the pandemic did complicate things because resources had to be diverted away from its development to things like the hybrid working of the Parliament, for which we had no advance notice or provision or additional staffing that we could deploy other than that which was currently working on the website. So, I mean, I think I would take issue with the idea that the corporate body isn't being advised of all of these things. But, Michelle?
Yes. On your point about governance, I want to just reiterate that there was clear governance in place, the governance that we would normally follow in terms of projects and the various strata of that I've outlined. I'm happy to provide a note with my colleagues on what that entails. Clear delegations to group heads for their operational areas of accountability, for budget performance and administration of that. Clear checks in our financial systems. Audit with an external audit board with Audit Scotland on it. We have a risk register which the leadership group regularly review in terms of our risks. We have quarterly performance reporting against delivery of our delivery plan and our strategic plan using the RAG status which Jackson has noted, so that we are constantly reprioritising, tackling issues, addressing risk, seeking to mitigate risk, and also ensure proper financial and performance management of the organisation.
Everything you've said, I'm entirely familiar with, and I've no doubt it's happening, but it's clear that given we've got this session today and what's come out of the concerns of the Finance Committee, that there's clearly been a mismatch, and it's that mismatch that I am pulling out. There's clearly been a mismatch, and if it were me, I'd be looking carefully to avoid that mismatch happening again. I want to move on, though, because I know every colleague wants to come in. And again, just picking up a comment that Daniel's made. Now, I wouldn't necessarily agree about the methodology used for projects. We know that the world has moved on from waterfall projects. But within the figures, where we've got an agile kind of methodology, which of course is sold by the IT consultants as much more flexible, what it often can mean is that you have increased costs where you're developing multiple prototypes and costs can mount in that area, and it's sold as a benefit. You don't do this huge big analysis project up front that then is out of date. And I do notice, looking at the figures, and I'm not entirely sure what's fitting in where, but between, oh, my thing has just died and I have to log in again, but so I may be able to quote the figures in a minute, but between the alpha and beta phases, there clearly was quite a number of prototypes going on, which looked to me disproportionately high, could even suggest that different personnel were coming in and going out. Because the whole point of Agile is that you're developing a prototype, you're testing it, and it's iterative as compared to the old water flow approach. So perhaps, Alan, you'd like to give us more context about that.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, what I would say about the approach very, very quickly, just to assure people, I mean, this is the approach that is used now by the Government Digital Services down in the UK Government and by the Scottish Government for the digital projects. I mean, waterfall is still used, I mean, but the terminology they use is almost a bimodal approach depending on what the project is. So it's quite a familiar approach. I mean, in terms of the iteration, your particular point, I think, you know, the iterations that we delivered were lots of different additions to the initial prototype. So we were adding more services as we went. We did do user testing as a part of those and refine some of those. In fact, some of the feedback we received from the corporate body around things like the postcode search and these sort of things meant that we changed the order of presentation of things like that. So it wasn't just that we were polishing a particular set of functionality; we were continuing to add functionality, moving towards that goal of actually moving across to the what was the beta site to be our actual website, and then let the old site wither on the vine at that point.
Yeah. And I'm not disagreeing with what you're saying. I'm just saying that based on my experience, this is an area in using agile methodologies where costs can incur because you've got a multi-layering effect. And again, from a risk perspective, that's something I'm very much aware of as a former IT project manager many years ago, I have to concede. My last question, though, is in terms of the typical project continuum, you always have this trade-off between cost, time and quality. So I'd like an honest reflection, perhaps from all of you, is in those areas, what did you trade in terms of time, cost or quality? And knowing what you know now, what you would trade? And if anyone says time, cost and quality was all of equally high standard, all the evidence tells it that that is never the case for IT projects. So I'll start with you, Jackson, although I appreciate you'll need to bring your staff in. So time, cost or quality?
I don't know that I came to those value judgments in the development any more than I do over whether it's time, quality or cost on the lift refurbishment programme either. I think the key thing I would say in all of this is that the corporate body is acutely aware that this is public money. That's where we start from in our examination. And that what we have to have is a product which matches the quality and expectation of the Parliament. But we defer and delegate to those people charged with that responsibility to take it forward. We don't interfere in an executive way in the operational decisions you've just asked about. So I will invite...
Knowing what you know now, you'll certainly be asking in the future about what is being traded in time, cost and quality.
Well, I mean, the Finance Committee has its variable interests from one year to the next. It very often used to be the commissioners that I was interrogated at excruciating length about. But so, I mean, the interest of the Finance Committee can shift in any given year, given the priorities of the public understanding of the work of the Parliament. But, I mean, the question you put, I think, has to go to those people who were charged with
delivery. I think Alan probably is.
So,
Alan.
Well, I think you rightly recognise the difficult balance we're faced with, with any project, really, around the time, cost and quality. And I think, we were very conscious of the fact that if we gave on, took too long in developing our staff and getting them up to speed, then the costs would increase. Because of the model that we chose to use in terms of using the contractors. So we always thought it was going to take about 3 years, and we put a large push on, despite COVID, really, to make sure we were finishing roughly on time for that one. So the time and the cost element was there. At that point, we had the capability then built in-house to improve the quality. So I guess, if anything, we gave a little bit on the quality. We're trying to serve multiple masters on the quality in terms of the different users of our website. There's quite a variety of users, members, the staff, the public for our engagement needs and these sort of things, and also political commentators and journalists. They all use our website. So I guess a little bit on the quality, if anything, that we gave on. I mean, it's delicate balance always. You're moving these things and judging these things around on a function by function basis.
Well, and perhaps my last little question off the back of that, I perhaps take a different view to some of the people in the committee, in that I was surprised that this work hadn't been started in a period of 10 years when it was known that the operating system had become obsolete. IT and provisioning for IT is invariably expensive and only goes one way in any organisation. So my question is, that seems to me to have been quite a long time to have started the project. And that, I'd appreciate your reflections, Alan, and I suppose that goes back to my comment about maybe everyone needs to understand this is an ongoing, risky, built-in cost to the Parliament all of the time, because that's the nature of IT and digital. But I'd just like to understand what took so long.
Yeah, I think we would have liked to have started it a little bit earlier, to be honest, and actually been able to maintain it. I mean, when we put the previous website in place, it was done by a contractor who basically completed that task and then moved on. So we were left looking to support it. We went through quite a lot of resourcing issues within the IT team. We still struggle to recruit and retain people to actually get things going in the project. And also there was changes at the sort of senior management level in terms of ownership of the website and the services around that, with Susan Latterley taking on halfway through the project, or quite late on in the project as well. So I think, in an ideal world, we would have moved a little bit faster. But in terms of resourcing and finance available and these sort of things, this is about the time that the Parliament waited. We were getting by, I think, for quite a few years. Mm-hmm. And we were quite content with that at that point in time. But it just got to the point where we were worried about a catastrophic failure. We'd been notified by the National Cybersecurity Centre that because it's no longer getting updated and improved, it was presenting a cyber risk. They actually identified that someone had an attack on it, part of a government attack against the UK government, actually. But they also probed our website and looked for spaces in there as well. And I think these were the final straw that really got us moving on that.
I'm not surprised to hear that. Susan, I'd like to bring you in here at this point, because I think this is my final question. And there's been a few areas where we've talked about what is in effect comms, intracoms, in terms of the various governing bodies and also to the committee. Is there anything you would like to add to the record that you would perhaps consider doing differently?
I think that the point you make about the continuous improvement, I think, is a very good one, because you were asking earlier on about the balance, and Alan was also talking about when we have to make that judgment. So we judged that in March 2021 that the technical platform was in place, and at that point we would be able to hand that over internally. Now, we knew at that point that there were still aspects that we wanted to look at sort of immediately to try and improve further. We will always have, though, a rolling programme of continuous improvement as things evolve and as we get more feedback. But at that time, we took the decision that we wanted to move across at that point, because we felt we were in a position where we could take this forward. We wanted to not to incur any further costs through keeping external contractors on for longer than we needed to. And also, because that was the end of the parliamentary session, we also wanted to have the new website in place for the new parliamentary session.
Not quite the question I asked, but I'll let it go to let other people come in. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Douglas, we're followed by John.
Thanks, Convener. But sort of questions are not around the functionality of the website, but it's back to the whole project initiation process and governance. Some questions are, was it an agreed project and who signed it off? Was the overall cost of the project budget approved and by who? Was the scope of the project agreed and by who? And was the timescales of the project agreed and by who?
I think the answer to that is largely yes, and by the corporate body, but on the advice that we received.
Yes, yeah, so the Digital Strategy Board is the board which puts together its various more than just this project, yeah, other projects, which then goes up to Strategic Resources Board. I chair that board currently. And what we do there is look at the entire Parliament budget to advise the corporate body on what's going to be taken to run the Parliament, keep the lights on and improve the Parliament, or address risk where we've got things that are going to fall over or prevent or provide a cyber security risk, etc. And at that board, then we have an additional challenge function based on all of the challenge that's gone on before in the business areas to kind of look at the nature and shape of the different pots that make up the Parliament budget, but also within that, the different pots that make up the project spend. When we're satisfied with that, we advise the corporate body at a number of different meetings on what the Parliament's overall budget is. The SPCB are the ultimate body that signs off the bid that goes forward to scrutiny by this committee.
But would the corporate body know the overall cost of this website project being over £3 million, or would they just be presented with this year it's going to cost 100k and next year it's going to cost a couple of hundred more k?
So usually the corporate body look at, I mean, we're working on an annual, obviously, budgeting cycle, so the corporate body look at that. As I've said a while ago, what we've been doing over the last 4 years is trying to improve the project pipeline, which looks ahead, obviously, to where we might have multiple years of spend on delivering something like the lifts or the web or other things like that. And we've improved that. So the corporate body now is starting to get that overview.
So at this time, the corporate body wouldn't have been aware of the overall cost of the project. The finance committee wouldn't have been aware of the overall cost of the project. You know, it's like me going out to buy a car. I don't buy the wheels 1 year and the engine the next. I need to know how much a car's going to cost.
Yeah, the corporate body would have known that the cost was within the indicative budget that was going up for each financial year. But looking back, there wouldn't have been a total cost at that spend, of that spend that the Finance Committee would have seen. So that's the thing.
So that's a complete failing then. Somebody, you know, a project's been approved without people knowing the overall cost of the project.
Because
it almost seems like there's frame agreements been in place, which has almost been handled by, it's almost like a maintenance project of a website, just, you know, adding a bit more on every year. Because you don't have a total, it didn't go out to tender, so you don't know what the total cost is going to be, or maybe somebody did. You don't know what the scope is going to be because you haven't drawn that up because there's no tender process, or maybe I'm wrong.
So the tender process, I think Alan addressed, it was using existing frameworks which had been tendered on behalf of the public sector. So there was a tender process. We were using a framework.
There was a tender process for the resource that was going to be doing this project.
Yeah.
There wasn't a tender process for the overall project. So nobody could know what the overall project was going to cost.
Well,
or maybe somebody did.
No, there was an estimate for the overall cost, which the Digital Strategy Board had for the overall cost based on estimates in each of the financial years, which I think we'd set out in our response to you. And there was the number of years. And then when the committee took evidence, we obviously also talked about the fact in that evidence, in one of the two evidence sessions, about the fact it was a multi-year project, but spend was within each indicative budget.
Yeah.
Level for each of the financial years. So the spend was contained within the annual budgeting cycle. There wasn't additional spend, if you like.
No, but there was no elected members were ever told of the complete overall project cost of this project.
So in 2016, when we put up our evidence, we set out a number of things in the project schedule, which some of which would be contained as projects within an annual year, some of which were going to be things that we flagged at the time might be across financial years, which we did with the website. But what we didn't have was this is going to cost £2.9 million in totality. Now, that is the thing, I think, that now we've got the project pipeline, we can go back and start to address for you in terms of saying, this is what we are going to spend our time on in the current financial year when you're scrutinising our budget, but we expect it to run, to be a feature in quite a few of our budgets.
So I guess from Michelle's point, then that is a sort of lesson that has been learned, that there is overall project cost now.
I mean, I think we've matured our project pipeline approach over the last few years, and we can start to then, I think, bring more of that to the table whenever we're coming in front
and,
of you.
And in terms of the... last point, Convener. In terms of the scope of the project, was that agreed at the outset, or is that just something that's been added to over the multiple years?
I'll let Alan come in, because he was involved in the scope.
So we undertook a discovery phase within the first year, really, which outlined what we were going to do then in terms of the scope. And also, that was at the same time then we further identified the, you know, the lifetime and cost of the project.
And who would have that scope? Who was that then agreed with? Was that back to the corporate body, or who was...
The scope didn't come up to the corporate body, as far as I'm aware. I mean, there was an update to the corporate body after that, outlining what we were going to be doing. But it was a high-level update presented in March of that year. Before we kicked off the financial year of 18-19, it was presented to the Digital Strategy Board. Prior to that, the project board would have taken that information.
Yeah. So it didn't seem like the corporate body had any real... They weren't presented with the facts either then of what the project was actually going to do and what the overall cost was. So maybe they seem to have been as much in the dark as the Finance Committee at that time.
Can I just come in on that? Because obviously we've gone back and looked over the various documentation over the years, and the delegation to officials is to develop and do all of the rigour around business cases being approved, challenged, and assurance that those can be delivered, and doing the budgeting and putting that advice up, where the Strategic Resources Board then looks like the strategic shape of the overall Parliament budget, just, you know, juxtaposing the various elements that we need to balance. So the business case would be something that would sit at senior level with officials to approve the detail of the business cases. And then we have various checks and balances on that as well. But the corporate body would not be signing off detailed business cases for projects, of which there are, I think, as Jackson has alluded to, many in different areas of running the Parliament in any given year.
But the corporate body is putting forward a budget that's been then approved by the Finance Committee without us knowing what the overall cost is.
But we do talk to the corporate body about the key areas of project spend, what they're going to deliver strategically for the Parliament, be that addressed risk, etc. And then we put forward the budget saying, and this is what's accommodated in our project schedule. But what you're talking about is that forward look saying...
Exactly, because they weren't given the complete project spend, so it's difficult for them to, well, not approve it, because they don't know how much it's going to be in total over, you know, a number of years.
But what we were saying to them was it's affordable in each annual budget, and it was affordable in each annual budget. That's our assurance to the corporate body. But I take on board your point that we can set out that forward look and report it on that a bit more to both you and the corporate body.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Fiona.
Yeah, there's a few things I can afford, but it doesn't mean we necessarily have to buy them. John, to be followed by Liz.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, just a couple of points. And I think, to be fair, I am slightly more sympathetic towards yourselves than some of my colleagues have been. I mean, this has come in roughly on time and roughly on budget, which I think is actually a good result, given that we have had much experience of other IT projects which haven't. I mean, if I could just, first of all, just mention something I find a little bit difficult about the new website and for searching for things. I mean, I don't use the website that much, but sometimes I'm looking for a motion, and I was looking for a motion. I knew I had written a motion on councillor pay, and I searched councillor pay, and it gave me no results. And then I thought, well, maybe it was something else. So I thought councillors pay, and it gave me one result, which was my motion. And I just wonder if the public might struggle with that kind of thing, because unless they know that they're for the exact words that have been used in a motion, they would struggle to find it. But I'll leave that with you, because you have said that the site will be developed. And my other point is really just probably to reiterate what others have said, because I don't think I was on the Finance Committee at that point when this started. But, and I think you are, Ms Haggerty, you've already said that you're going to kind of present information slightly differently in the future. But I suppose I'd just like a re-emphasis, an acceptance that I think it is very important for the Finance Committee to know if a project is going to run onto several years. And I think that did actually happen with some of the security enhancements, which went over more than 1 year, and which I remember being on the committee, and we did ask, and we did get the information that it would go over more than 1 year. Because the risk, as I think others have just pointed out, presumably, is that if you came back to the Finance Committee in year two and money was tight, there's a risk that they could have said no to the budget in year two, and that would presumably have meant all the money in year one had been wasted. So I do think it's very important for the Finance Committee, whoever's on it, to know what they're committing to, because effectively, correct me if I'm wrong, but the Finance Committee is committing to a five-year project when normally we only commit budgets 1 year at a time. So there's a risk to the corporate body that your second, third, fourth and fifth year budgets might get knocked back if the Finance Committee doesn't understand that they are making a commitment for 5 years. Am I understanding that correctly? Is that right?
So the Finance Committee is scrutinising the overall Parliament budget in terms of the totality of the Parliament budget and all the various bits that make it up. And project spend is only 4.5 to 5 million out of 112 million. So in considering other organisations, and we maintain it at that kind of level over many years, we've maintained our project budget at that level. But that involves choices, and so officials do have to scrutinise different projects. We have to take a risk-based decision. Back to the convener's point about affordability, that is one of the considerations. And we do eke out the life of things in order to push out costs where we see that we can do that without catastrophic risk for the organisation. So, for example, the last time we replaced all of the consoles and the microphones in the chamber, we harvested a lot of that equipment so that it could eke out the life of what you've got in the committee room, so that we were looking at affordability in the round in terms of how we use our project spend. And that's because we have to make choices, we have to make priority decisions every year. And then on top of that, as we've had for the last couple of years, we get a bit of a crisis situation, which means that we're having to pedal quite furiously to be able to address the increased resourcing costs to the organisation, like enhanced cleaning, new service delivery so we could operate during the pandemic, additional equipment for people to work at home, so that we could manage that and these projects, like the website, within our project budget without asking for more money, which is what we managed to do. So we constantly reprioritise within our project budget in year, and we seek to also look at spend across the years when we look at our medium-term financial planning, which is what we'll be speaking to you about when we come back in December again.
Yes, no, I mean, I think, certainly myself, I'm convinced that you are trying to keep costs down and not spend, and there is a balance between preventative maintenance and kind of reactive and so on and so forth. Mm. But I think I just finally stress that yes, it is very important that the Finance Committee understands if a project is going to be lasting longer, because effectively the Finance Committee is pre-approving what would normally just be a year-by-year budget. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Liz.
Can I just follow on that point, and can I draw the panel's attention to the letter that the committee received from the presiding officer, in which she says, just towards the end, that, and I quote, "officials have recognised the need to provide increased detail on multi-year project costs as part of the annual budgeting process, and that, that this committee should note that because it is one of the Parliament's larger investments, the project is scheduled to be reviewed as part of the internal audit programme." Can I just ask when that audit is due? And secondly, can I just seek confirmation that the results of that would be passed to this committee?
It will be within the current financial year. I will get back to you on specifically when we anticipate that in the audit programme to happen. But it will be, it's scheduled for the current financial year. And then I believe it's a matter of public record. Those documents are available. But yes, certainly.
Yeah, I just think, just following Mr. Mason's point, that that when it comes to multi-year projects, it's very important that we can scrutinise that. Obviously, we have to look at things on a yearly basis, but just the forecasting for projections is important to the scrutiny of this committee. So any information we could have at that time of that internal audit would be immensely helpful to us if that was possible. And the second thing I want to ask, which again is in the presiding officer's letter, where she says that the investment that has been made has achieved certain things. And she says that it's more resilient, stable, flexible and a robust website. We've obviously heard that varying views on that. But she secondly says that, you know, it has reduced the possibility of a really awful cyber attack, which we all have to accept as public bodies, sadly, these days can happen. We saw recently what happened to SEPA and how that problem made life very difficult for at least two of the committees in this Parliament, the Environment Committee and also the Rural Affairs Committee in the last Parliament, and obviously that had implications for the work that the Parliament could do. Without giving away any state secrets, can I just ask about why we are confident that the possibility of a cyber attack has been addressed by this new system? Because I think it's a very important point that, you know, if we were to have a cyber attack, it could cause us huge problems.
Convener, can I just begin by acknowledging and thanking the officials who have tirelessly worked to ensure that the sustained efforts that the corporate body have been advised of external parties who have sought to break into and corrupt our network have been frustrated and defeated on each occasion. It is something the corporate body has taken quite seriously. We received briefings, I seem to remember, from GCHQ, which was obviously very exciting. But there has been a genuine and sustained effort, and we have worked, and I know the team have worked incredibly hard to frustrate that and have succeeded. And I know that in developing the new website, as Alan will now explain, the understanding that that is an ongoing issue is very much to the fore of our thinking.
Yep. So, just come in. Thank you. So we have built in you know, good cyber practices from the off in this project, really, for the design. That was one of the major risks of the old site. So there's two things we're really doing to reduce the risk. I mean, I'm not going to be complacent and say that we have eliminated the risk. We never can eliminate this. We're, you know, we're always hopefully going to be one step ahead of the bad people that will do this. But, you know, you can't guarantee you'll always stay ahead. But two things we really put in place. With the new website, with the team we have on board now, we are able to update that and maintain that and keep that up to date, just as you would do on your mobile phone. You get app updates and these sort of things. We get that for the actual system that runs it, so we make sure they're applied in timely fashion as fast as possible. So that helps us prevent, you know, known faults becoming an issue for us in terms of a cyber attack. The other thing we undertake regularly with the website is actually what is called a penetration test. So we'll actually test it against, you know, to see if there are any faults, and we'll address those faults or weaknesses that are identified within that. So we're coming at it from two perspectives. One is the preventative side, and one is actually trying to actually, you know, tackle the cyber attack ourselves to see if we can actually break that. And we've also take advice and guidance from the Resilience Centre, the Scottish Government Resilience Centre, and also from the National Cyber Security Centre as well around our security for this. So it's,
thank you.
That's a key thing to us.
That's very helpful, and I think very encouraging. My very final point, which again comes back to what the presiding officer was saying, which you've alluded to as well this morning, that one of the reasons for the redesign is to ensure that it's more accessible and user-friendly for members of the public and people who are outside this building. What are we doing to measure the responses of these stakeholders so that we know that what we have done is helping people to understand this place a bit better and to contribute to it?
Yeah. Happy to take that. I mean, throughout the course of putting the website in place, we tried to do a lot of consultation with a number of stakeholders, and going forward, we want to continue with this. But in terms of particularly what you were asking about people who are external to the Parliament, on the website, we have constantly something at the top, which basically we ask people to give us feedback in terms of what they think about the website. And what we do as part of the programme of continuous improvement is we take the results of that feedback together with feedback that we get from internal users, specifically members, and we held a drop-in session back in March for members and their staff, and we'll be holding another one in June, and we want to hold that on a quarterly basis because we think it's really important that we try and capture feedback from all of the different users and that we use that to make improvements to the website. Because just going back to something that I think Alan or Jackson said earlier on, we're aware we've got a number of different users, and it can be a complex process trying to build something which is going to meet the needs of all of those users. But certainly from an engagement perspective, what was key for us was making sure that people who didn't know how the Parliament was structured, how it was operated, would be able more easily to find out to find things. But we will continue to act on that feedback.
So is that feedback relatively positive just now from people out with the building?
I think as with most feedback, it's, you know, we have a bit of a mix. We can have a mixed bag. There are people who very much like the way that the website's structured. Some people who have perhaps given us some constructive suggestions. So I wouldn't pretend that it's overwhelmingly positive, but nor is it overwhelmingly negative. It's probably, as would be expected, a mixed bag.
Okay.
I can say, I mean, there have been a number of ways in which we've responded already to feedback, and there are a number of initiatives that are already planned. And just to say also, it's not just the range of users. One of the most significant things that I think the team had to accommodate was the different ways in which people are now seeking to access the website, with a huge shift to mobile digital technology seeking to access it, which simply was not something the previous system was capable of sustaining.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. That's concluded questions from other members of the committee. I've just got one or two to round up with. One, for example, on the issue of cost is the annual licensing support cost. That hasn't come up, but I notice that's increased from £54,000 to £86,000. So just kind of an explanation as to why we have that significant jump in cost.
Tammy, I actually think I know that, but I think you probably should have the, because I think we asked that question as well. So.
Yep. So, I mean, it's a different product we're using, really, to the platform for the website now, and it costs more, but it's a better product. It actually gives us a lot more functionality for our engagement side as well. So there's a lot more to it, basically. You know, it's a more fulsome product, really, that we're using, and so therefore it costs more on an annual basis.
Okay. So having covered the cost and scrutiny, I just want to cover one other issue, which is really quality, and it's just in response to a comment that Alan made earlier on. So we had the referendum in September 97 to set up this Parliament, and 20 months later the Parliament was established with a functioning website which served us for many years. I recall there were many IT problems. For example, we only had a capacity of like 50 megabytes in our inbox, and there were constant issues. But I don't remember many difficulties with the website, I have to say. But I think we would all accept that, nevertheless, we have to evolve. You know, it's more than 20 years have elapsed, obviously, and there have been some upgrades. But this was a mega one. But in response to Michelle, when Michelle Thompson talked about, you know, the trade-offs between time, quality, etc., Alan said we had to give a little in quality. But surely, if you're taking more than 3 years to develop a project, more than £3 million has been spent, you shouldn't have to concede anything in quality. And where have we conceded that quality?
Yep. So.
It was you that said it.
Yes, it was, yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, no.
That's right.
So I think what we considered a little bit in quality, I think, is to make sure that we didn't keep the project running. As you've rightly highlighted, convened today, that the project was costing us money just every day, basically, for the contractor costs, which you've talked about. So we wanted to finish that as quickly as we could so we could move this on to our own team. In doing so, we accepted that maybe not everything was perfect. You know, we could have kept polishing this for many years. But we really didn't want to continue on with that cost. We knew that we'd changed our whole model across the organisation to a continuous improvement, continuous development model for the website. And that's exactly what we were going to do, is to continue to improve that, seeking feedback from different people on that.
But a basic thing that I referred to earlier on is the fact that, you know, you have to go on the old website to look at the official report. I mean, surely that's a nonsense. And I don't think it's just a coincidence that since this new website came up, we now, for the first time in more than 20 years, get sent the official report every day so that we don't really have to go on to it one might suspect. I mean, surely
Peter, that's my fault, I have to say, because I have become increasingly concerned since we stopped producing paper copies of the official report that parliamentarians haven't been bothering to access the official report and potentially have less familiarity with the general business within the parliament than was the case before. So I specifically, for no reason other than that it would be of enormous value to me, requested that the official report be taken out of the general kind of go and find it category to one that would be proactively sent to all members on a daily basis, as the old paper copy used to be.
Okay, but surely if it was more accessible online, most people would just access it online and wouldn't have to have it actually sent to them on a daily basis. I mean, surely. But I mean, we'll leave that.
Sure,
then.
That's what happened.
We'll leave it at that. But just one final thing, and it was just basically from Susan. She talked about we have to eke out the life of equipment, and yet this very day, IT people are in my office, both constituency and upstairs, telling me that they have to replace laptops, which I think some of the staff have only had for less than a year, etc., and all sorts of other technology. We had some discussions about retaining some of it because we didn't want to lose any of it. It all works pretty well as far as we're concerned. It's certainly a lot better than it used to work a few years back. So what is the necessity of that project, and what's the cost going to be? Just the overall cost, because we'll obviously maybe want to scrutinise that further later in the year.
So we're refreshing the technology used by return members now. We have done it obviously after the election. We refreshed the technology, give out technology to the new members. What we are doing with that is we're making sure that you have the latest version of Windows installed on that. Now, this is key for us to maintain our estate. Really, you need to be working on the latest version so it's compatible with other applications, but also maintaining our cybersecurity stance, so that there are no known issues with that. It'd be fine if everyone worked in Holland and was hidden behind our hard shell, but that's not the way things have worked out over the last 2 years. So we are refreshing those. The easiest way for us to do that is replace all of the equipment at that time. That equipment, if it's not more than 4 years, will then be reused elsewhere further down the line, so it will actually bubble down as we go about. So we've got a fighting stock, if you like, that we put together so that we can actually replace equipment for members, and then we'll actually reuse the equipment that still has good value to us. So we do try and eke out. Yeah. We're very conscious of the sort of tension, I guess, between sustainability angle and the speed of equipment and the longevity of the lifespan of equipment sitting in there.
Yeah, I can understand the software upgrade. It was just the hardware that I found surprising. Actually,
it's actually easier for us to upgrade the whole thing at once. It's more cost-effective way for us to do that, and then use that equipment that we've taken back from you, if it's still serviceable, to actually pass on to somebody else. But again, it would be fully updated before passing on to them.
Okay. Well, thank you for that, and thank you very much for your evidence today. The committee will consider any next steps arising from today's session at a future meeting, and we also look forward to considering the SPCB's budget bid for 23-24 towards the end of the year as part of our wider budget scrutiny process. So that concludes the public part of today's meeting. Next item on our agenda, we'll discuss a private paper and consideration of a work paper. So we'll now move into private sessions. We'll just have a two-minute recess while we allow the official report and witnesses to leave.